Good evening, everyone. I would like to call the January 19th, 2016 meeting of the Reading Board of Selectmen to order. I'll first go over tonight's agenda. We'll first have Selectmen liaison reports and comments, followed by public comment and the town manager, assistant town manager's report. We will then, under discussion action items, have a hearing for alteration of premises for Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza, 48 Walker Brook Drive, the patio plan, at 7 o'clock. At 7:10, we'll begin our budget discussions. The areas of the FY17 town budget we'll be discussing this evening are public safety, fire and EMS, public safety police, public safety dispatch, public library, public works, enterprise funds, benefits and miscellaneous, capital and debt, and budget summary. And there's no minutes to approve this evening?
Nope.
Okay, no executive session.
Correct.
Okay, I believe, Bob, you had a comment to lead off.
I do. I have a statement to read. On the afternoon of Monday, January 18th, Reading Police responded to the scene of an accident in the vicinity of 249 Lowell Street involving a town of Reading sidewalk plow and an injured pedestrian. The pedestrian was taken by ambulance to a local hospital where he later died from his injuries. The State Police Accident Reconstruction Team is investigating the incident. Our hearts go out to everyone who was involved in this tragic accident. Because this is an ongoing investigation, we cannot offer any further details or comments at this time. A further statement may be issued once the Accident Reconstruction Team completes its investigation.
Thank you, Bob. Let's go to liaison reports. I'll start on my right. John Arena.
I'm still trying to get cold from tonight's weather. What a change from December. But other than that, nothing to report yet.
John?
I have nothing new to report.
Barry?
It's
only been a week.
Yeah, I know. I actually had the pleasure and the honor of attending the Martin Luther King celebration that the Human Relations Advisory Committee put on yesterday. It was a fabulous event at the high school. It was really, really well attended, and a variety of different organizations participated. The Reading Community Singers, the Korean Church Choir, and one of the things that really struck me was the Metco chorus of those little kids that just like pulled at your heartstrings. It was really great. The inspirational speech was given by Thomas Avila, who was an activist in the Hispanic community in Rhode Island, and basically told about how their community organizing efforts really increased the political participation of Hispanics in Rhode Island, and that was a really sort of empowering message that he gave. So really well done. I think the Human Relations Advisory Committee really should be given a real congratulations for their efforts. It was, you know, people left there feeling really good, and it was a well done. It's going to be aired, I think, on RCTV at some point, and I think also it can be viewed on their Facebook page. They're going to have a YouTube link for it. So for those of who couldn't make it on that day, I really encourage you to look through it. A number, a variety of Reading businesses contributed: Bagel World, Honeydew, a couple of other businesses, so really contributed to the breakfast. So it was a really, you know, really good community effort that I was really jazzed to go to. So well done to the Human Relations Advisory Committee.
Thanks a lot. Kevin?
I have nothing to report.
Nor do I. Okay, is there any public comment on any item that is not otherwise on the agenda tonight? Okay, hearing none, Gene, did you want to give the report?
Good evening. I wanted to take an opportunity to let the board know that we have received the filing for Reading Village 40B. And so I believe Bob has books for you tonight, so that everyone here on the board is aware of the filing. There are two dates that are important to note. The Zoning Board of Appeals will be opening the public hearing on Thursday night, February 4th. And we are working with the developer too, and they have so far showed us a very collaborative style, which we very much appreciate. We are going to be catching up with them on a conference call later this week. And also, we did do a preliminary quick review of the application and had a few questions, comments, requests for clarification on a few points. This is the and they were extremely very good about getting back to us, getting us the information, and very receptive. So those are all very positives on a project that I know is going to have a lot of discussion. This is 77 units on 35,000 square feet, roughly. So that's a density level of 93 units per acre. In planning circles, that's five or six times even what we do under 40R. So it's an extraordinarily dense development. It's the 63 point something feet high, so it'll be probably likely one of the tallest buildings in the town.
Did you say 93?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Make sure I didn't mishear 9.3.
How tall are those current buildings, do you know, the Doucette buildings?
I don't know exactly.
This is taller than those buildings?
It's taller.
Oh, yeah.
Good amount.
Yeah. This is taller than anything that you could do under the smart growth zoning, which is the dense zoning.
Yep.
And they have asked for a number of waivers. There's a whole page of them under tab 9. And that's where you can see the real difference under a 40B project versus what's allowed under zoning. So there are any number of things from parking to height, setbacks, lot shape, on and on and on, that indicate that this is going to be a very dense development. And so anyway, I just wanted to kind of give the board a heads up. We look forward to within the next day or two filing a grant application with the state. The Mass Housing Partnership provides technical assistance, and so that we chatted with them today, and they told us for a fact we'd get the money and the help. They already have the pre-qualified consultants. The consultants are consultants they hire and they contract with and they pay and they assign to us. So we had indicated some of the consultants that we were familiar with that we were interested in. Now it's just a matter of finding out which ones would be most available to us. The zoning board's meeting on obviously on Thursday nights. That might be tricky for one consultant over another. So we want to make sure that we get the most available, most experienced consultant. And what the consultant will do is assist the zoning board and clarify some of the areas that we should be asking more questions about. And then if there are more expertise that is needed, say for example parking, then the developer will be responsible for paying for the expense of that consultant to assist the zoning board with the comprehensive permit. And as I think, I'm just assuming people know, maybe you don't, the comprehensive permit process is what a 40B goes through. They bypass all local zoning. They do not go through site plan review. They do not go before the planning board. So everything is pretty much up for grabs. But it's the Zoning Board of Appeals that will have the ability to put conditions on this comprehensive permit. And that's where the nuances of the project come into play in the negotiation. And so we're, so far, as I said, the developer has been very receptive to some discussion back and forth with the town, and I see that as a big positive.
Gene, you mentioned the height being 90 feet.
No, 60.
63.
Oh, okay. Point yeah. Something or other.
The waiver is asking 57.5 versus existing height of 44.
Is that the bill?
Third item down on the first page of the waiver request, section 9. Okay.
Third item.
I thought somebody said 90. Maybe I misheard.
No, it's... They're saying that the what's allowed under zoning is 35 feet.
Right.
But if you go to the pullout, I think that's probably the easiest, under tab tab 11, there's a graphic that shows the heights pretty much towards the end.
Just for the record, Gene, that's height of the construction or height of the improvements on the construction, like a smokestack?
Yeah, the graphic will make it really clear, because the way we define height is to the ridge line of the roof.
Right, right. For consistency.
I think some of it, I remember.
Sorry, it's on the architectural's under 13.
13.
So it's the one that looks like, it's got the building and it shows the height, like a, looks like this.
Oh, here it is, yep.
Cross section.
So that cross section shows you that it's 53 feet, 7 inches.
To the top, yeah.
And it's to the top of the ridge.
And to the best of your knowledge, Gene, just on the subject of height, do you know of any other building in town that approximates that height?
That height, no.
Not the task building?
Yeah, maybe the Walker's Brook.
Maybe the water tower.
I can't think of anything.
Stars, so I think that's over 60.
Yeah.
Gary?
Yeah, Gene, obviously this is going bypassing regular zoning right to a comprehensive permit. And, you know, and you said that the developer's been forthcoming. There's going to be a certain point where they want this and we want that. What's the leverage that the zoning board has, to kind of make some of the changes? Because at a certain point, isn't the developer, I mean, they can basically do what they want. So where's the leverage from the town? And I just, is it parking? Is it public safety? Is it?
We've got to have something to hang our hat on to condition certain things. So let's say the parking, we have a parking consultant. The consultant says, well, really, you don't have this or that with regard to parking. Then that's where you sit in a room and you say, look, it doesn't work.
Right.
So, you know, we have to figure this out. And Mass Housing Partnership has encouraged us to think about, and she said some communities don't like to do it this way. Maybe if the zoning board would be willing, and obviously this haven't even started yet, but if the zoning board would be willing to have one representative meet with a representative from the developers team to sit and negotiate, they encourage that.
Mm-hmm.
Like I say, that's up to the zoning board, obviously, but
right.
If that's something that could work, that might be the easiest way to try and come up with some kind of compromise.
Right. To Barry's point, in negotiation, you have common interests and diverse interests. What's the vehicle we have? It sounds like public safety, parking is one.
Yep.
Access for emergency vehicles might be a closely related second.
Yep.
But on the matter of construction details, that's probably where our hand is weakest or our ability to influence is weakest. Yeah?
Construction details, meaning methods of construction?
The density.
Oh. The density we really can't speak to.
Right, right. So it's things like public safety or egress or
public
ingress.
Safety, things about the site plan, if there's something on the roof that's going to cause a lot of noise. There needs to be some mitigation about that.
Water sewer capacity.
Right. All the things that they're asking for waivers from, they need to make a compelling argument that they're not going to create a public safety issue, a public infrastructure problem.
As a follow-up to that, are one of the things that could be looked at is the impact that the building has on other things. So for example, parking, there's not enough parking for that place, but could you show that, well, the overfill of parking will then hurt this business a block away? Is that a negotiable item, or is it just, you're just looking at the envelope of that building, but can you look at how that building impacts, you know, the spaces in between?
Or is there linkage, you know, linkage payments of any kind? Mitigating.
Yeah, so with parking, usually where it comes up, and their ratio is low, but if the ratio needs to come up maybe for off-street parking, maybe it needs to grow a little bit higher. And we have other properties to look at, like Oak Tree at 30 Haven.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we'll look at comparables and say, well, what do you really need for parking? You can talk zoning and ratios all day long, but in reality, what have we seen for similar types of dense, you know, living, housing like this? So there's that. And then the discussion will probably go something like, all right, now that we've figured out off-street parking for people who are going to live in this building, what about visitor parking? Where do visitors park?
Maintenance vehicles, delivery vehicles.
How do you, right, all of the things that go along with, how does the trash truck get in and out? How does, you know, all those things, and that would become part of a parking study, more than likely.
Again, to the same point, Haven was, is there already, Haven Street. Whatever incremental burden was put on-street parking is already in place. So arguably, additions to that area are additive and incremental, incrementally stressing, if you will. So whatever criteria might have been used for 30 Haven, the circumstances now are 30 Haven's there, you now need to look at the whole of the area with that present. Is there discretion to be applied in terms of whatever the comparables were, what they started with is different from where we are now years later with that all built out and residents present. Is it strict comparables, or is there adjustment for kind of density that the we've gotten to over time?
Well, I think we have to figure out what is the overflow parking demand likely to be? What is that number? You know, what's the ratio of visitors
of
that you could expect?
And
then once you quantify or have some general sense of that, then it's a question of, all right, well, where would they park? Because in the winter, there's no overnight parking. So you can't, and we had this conversation with Oak Tree as well. You can't park in a public lot overnight in the winter.
I get all that. My question is a little different. Are the rules the same for this enterprise relative to parking as they were for Haven Street, given that the area is much more built up years later? The world, it's a different place. It's a different density.
I don't think it matters.
I don't think so. I think you have to show
impact.
Really, what are we dealing with, and
right.
What's the solution? I mean, there are all kinds of ways you can do parking. You can do off-site parking. You can do shared parking. They could strike an agreement with Eastern Bank that during the winter months, they'll have 10 parking spaces for guest parking.
Got
for
it.
The, you know, there are all these different ways you come at this. But just by saying, I think what you're saying is, you know, we're a more developed downtown area now than we were 6 years ago, much more so. There's more foot traffic, there's more activity, which is good. But when you come to parking, that makes it a little trickier.
What's the ratio that this presently calls for? So for 93 units, how many spaces of parking is it called? 1.25?
They're going, 40R would have said 1.25. In this case,
it's barely,
1.06.
It was barely over one.
Something like that.
So who's going to drive that 6/10 of a car, 6/100 of a car?
It's 1.5 under the base zoning.
Okay.
And so their waiver is to allow 1.06 for a total of 83 parking spaces for 77 units.
Well, it's pretty far away from the mean.
Do we have any data, or can we get data about other 40Bs and ratios that have been?
I can tell you off the top of my head, Oak Tree had 78 underground parking spaces for
53
units. 53. Now, I can't tell you if they're using them all. I don't know.
Maybe they can negotiate a lease with the remaining.
Not
a 40R,
but another 40B or series of 40Bs. What sorts of parking ratios have been imposed in those cases? Can we get that data and see if it isn't more, and we can roll that up with perhaps?
But you need real comparables. It's wanting to have a 40B that's got 40 units.
I would compare it to a 40R.
You've also got to get comparables that are right in a train station.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the argument for less.
Yeah. I would think the parking consultant will spend a lot, and I would expect we would hire a parking consultant, because
that
we flag that issue right
now.
This
is on their nickel for all these consultants.
Yes.
Yeah.
So when we get the consultant from the state who will guide us, they'll point us in the right direction so that we're making sure we're crossing every T and dotting every I, and then when they say, well, you really need a parking consultant, that's when we'll get a parking consultant to come in and do the work that needs to be done on that issue.
So just as a, this is probably a silly question from a common sense standpoint, 83 parking places.
93. I'm sorry.
83.
77
units.
Yep.
How many of those are two-bedroom?
I'm not sure how many are two-bedroom, but I can tell you there's 10% that are three-bedroom.
I'm looking at one of them. So, we're to believe that one car essentially goes to one apartment. Plus, we've got this, we've got an extra six spaces, is that right?
Right.
Yeah, that's, that exercises a lot of common sense.
Anybody who's ever taken the commuter rail and parked their car down there.
Yeah, you know, there's no room.
There's no room now.
Well, I mean, you know, I'm wondering what happens if three people move into a three-bedroom place and they each have a car.
I believe there's 22 units that are two or more bedrooms.
22 or that are two or more?
That's what it looks like on this count here.
It's mostly studios and ones.
Yeah.
So when you rent one of these apartments, you don't get a parking place.
Right.
It's not guaranteed. No. It's a free-for-all.
Right.
Yeah. Right?
Right.
Yeah, usually.
And somebody at the state has indicated that this actually makes sense.
I don't think they passed judgment on that yet.
Yeah, we've met with a few folks from the state that came out and saw the site, and then they went back and they were part of the letter approving it. The initial letter of eligibility.
So it's pretty clear that those people felt that that actually made sense in 2016.
Well, what was the tone? Wasn't there a tone in the letter saying developer work closely with the town, listen to their concerns? What did you take away from that?
Once the developer gets that letter of eligibility, that's the ticket to go forward.
Yeah.
That's the biggest hurdle. And so they did make some points. They called them findings in the letter. And they basically echoed what we wrote as concerns, the parking and all the things that we keep talking about. So they cited them as findings and said that you need to work with the town on these issues.
Yeah, in some cases they used careful wording. One was work with the town, one was you must satisfy the town. Whether that really has any meat to it or not, none of us really know. Ray didn't really know. He said it was a little unusual in its tone. That it was, in favor.
It was a little more in our favor.
Yeah, but no one knows.
And so to clarify, the reason that we are put in this position is because our numerator and denominator of affordable housing is so inverted from the type of development that we've done over the last 15 years that, essentially we're hostages to whoever wants to come and do this. Yeah, just wanted to be sure I understood it.
Yeah, actually they don't update the universe of units, so the total units is not reflected in our inventory. They don't only do that every 10 years.
Oh.
So we're actually maybe a little bit worse than we look, because they're not counting all the units.
They haven't caught up, in other words. So we're really more upside down than the current
data. Even with all the projects that have come online the last.
The projects that have come online really have not helped net. They're doing the bare minimum by and large, except for rental property.
So the 40B over at Redding Woods, that doesn't.
No, you've got three units there.
They give you a fraction of what, in the grand scheme, it doesn't add to the total very much.
Right.
That's the problem.
Yeah, it may solve one or two extra units.
Relative to the ratios, they hit the bare minimums, so the inversion continues.
Where it really helps is such as North Reading that has land to develop, built rental apartments, all affordable.
Mm-hmm.
They all get counted.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That's where you win.
Yeah.
We have not done that.
This is rental.
Would count. This would count all 77 units, which would be a big plus.
That would be a big plus.
How many units were counted in Reading Woods?
43,
that's it. Because a lot were
condo. It ended up, if you look at Reading Woods and you divide it in quarters,
yeah,
only one quadrant is the 40R district.
Oh.
So that's
we get
where
credit for all the.
That's where it looks like we should be getting more, but we're just getting credit for those for the affordables.
Just for the affordable.
In the, say it's 200,
mm-hmm,
just the 43 in that quadrant.
And the friendly one on Woodburn Street will be about 22, and they're all countable.
20 units. I understand that at this point they're rental. Yes, and they're at 25%. You have to have that 25% number to get the full credit.
Right.
Like, that's why we didn't get the full credit for 30 Haven, because our zoning is 20% affordable for the 40R district. So we only got credit for the units, and in that case, it was only 11 units.
There's not a lot of common sense involved here.
We had done one more unit.
There's an absence of common sense.
Absolutely.
In both the way that we've developed ourselves and in the way that it's adjudicated.
Right.
I mean, it really makes very little, has very little common sense applied in either case. And so we've been, you know, we've created our own nightmare in some ways.
Any further points, John?
Gene, a couple of questions. The 82 or so spots, is that inclusive of spots for the support vehicles you described earlier, or is there additional room for trash pickup?
Yeah, those are just the off-street parking spaces.
So is there or is there not incremental space for support activities, or is that going to come out of the 82?
That's probably something that we're going to look at when we drill down into that site plan.
Okay.
How will we'll get information on turning movements and
okay.
where the deliveries go and
turning radii, and can the fire
yes.
truck get in there? And all
yes.
The second question is the letter of determination. Should I've always interpreted that as the proposal in front of us is worthy of being considered, not an endorsement of any of it, that it's all Bob's points about the careful selection of words. I'm wondering if we should read nothing into it other than it meets the minimum for consideration, and the rest of it is up to us as we kind of go through and drill into the plan and go through the process.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your interpretation as well?
Yeah, basically that's a letter of eligibility. So there, the state is saying in that letter, you are eligible to have to apply for
right.
a comprehensive mm-hmm. permit under this provision of state law. So they're giving them the green light.
It's a hunting license.
All the rest now is up to the town.
Right, you've met the minimum.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Did you say there was a second meeting or a second part of the process? You mentioned
yes.
the ZBA hearing.
The ZBA hearing will open, and then Bob and I are still working through some details on getting them to come before the Board of Selectmen and
okay.
perhaps invite the CPDC to join the Board of Selectmen so that you can hear the presentation as well. And for anybody else in the public that can't make it on February 4th.
In that regard, are there any board members that were planning to attend that meeting?
I was going to go, but I have a work conflict I'm trying to work
okay.
through. So
that's
I'm a maybe.
February
comes up.
Yeah, I'm actually suggesting we keep that at a minimum, just that out of courtesy to the people on the board that we appoint, so perhaps they don't feel unduly pressured to do anything when they see a room full of selectmen there. One or two is fine, I think, but I wouldn't want to see the whole board.
I thought I saw it posted as a joint meeting, but
no, I don't think so.
No,
it's possible we may have posted you in case there'd be a quorum, but that's up to you.
Yeah. I would encourage you, but the liaison certainly isn't invited. Is that you?
That's me.
Okay. But if you don't go, I'm sure it'll be on TV.
I will be there.
I'll go.
Okay.
And we did send out
okay,
the abutters letters last week.
Okay.
So that, if just as a heads up, if anyone gets a phone call, those went out in the mail last Thursday.
Just one last question. So, Gene, is there? You mentioned that there's a potential joint meeting of the Board of Selectmen and CPCD.
CPDC.
ABCD. is that the appropriate point for input from us, or is there?
I think
is it too late?
No.
There's real no authority from either board.
Exactly.
No, but input.
The purpose of the meeting. Yeah.
Yeah, we thought this might be a nice way to get comments out and maybe have discussion.
Well, would this be before they close their hearing, the ZBA?
Oh, yeah. We expect
okay.
the ZBA hearing to go on for quite
for
some
while.
Time.
Okay.
And so the ZBA wants to get
okay.
comments, and we thought this would be an efficient way to get everybody together
that
and
makes sense,
have
so.
Another opportunity for the public because.
Right.
Maybe a Thursday night isn't that convenient for people.
To your point, Barry, there's so many waivers here that it may take a couple or three passes to kind of get
oh,
the
sure.
points across, right?
Yeah.
So repetition is probably our
and
friend here.
And then as points come out, they'll be studied, it'll come back,
right.
and, you know, this is not, I mean, I hope they don't think they're getting it on the first night.
I don't think so, no.
Tell them to bring sleeping bags.
Yeah. Okay, any final questions? Gene, thank you.
Thank
you. Do
you
have anything else? Bob, do you have anything else?
No, I don't.
Okay, very good.
I have a
All right, are we ready for the hearing on Anthony's Coal Fire Pizza? Would the secretary like to read the notice?
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on January 19, 2016, at 7 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on the alteration of premise for Anthony's Coal Fire Pizza of Reading LLC at 48 Walker's Brook Drive. Copy of the proposed document regarding this topic will be available in the town manager's office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing by email prior to 6 p.m. on January 19, 2016, to the town manager at ci.reading.ma.us.
Thanks, Kevin. Okay, do we have a representative from Anthony's here this evening? Okay, could you introduce yourself and your team?
I'm Carolyn O'Connell, I'm counsel for Anthony's.
If I could also just start with a comment.
Yeah, sure.
This is largely a perfunctory matter in front of the board. The board approved a plan for a liquor license, and CPDC subsequently approved a slightly different version, which is why formally you have to approve the plan that CPDC saw.
What happened was when we submitted the plan, the legal description on the application did not have the verbiage that said the patio seats were on there, but the plan had the patio seats on there. Mm-hmm. So all we're really doing is trying to just have the description match what the proposed floor plan is.
Gotcha.
They seem very interested in opening the patio this month.
They like to open by Monday. So, well, the ABCC has said they will work with us on that and have someone waiting to inspect and hopefully issue the license this week. So I if you have any questions about the patio, I think the plan is fairly self-explanatory. It's six tables, 24 seats, four tables, 16 seats, covered patio, which is why they're going to be using it in January. Ms. No. Pretty easy.
Okay. Are there questions from the board?
No.
No.
Okay, good luck. Anything from the public here?
Actually, Mr. Chairman,
yes,
if I could, while you're here,
sure.
Can you know, probably you've got a lot of people watching on TV and folks here. You want to maybe
not really. You'd be amazed.
They have no life.
Maybe do like the 30-second on like your restaurant, the kind of menu, all that kind of stuff. So what we can expect.
So I'm Brent. I'm the regional manager, and this is Cody, he's the store manager. But it's a simple menu, mostly pizza. It's got a nice atmosphere with, you know, some classic music you guys will probably be familiar with. Sports pictures on the walls. You know, we're known for the chicken wings, the meatballs. We have a nice selection of local craft beers, but it's kind of just like a simple, small, fun place, really unique in style, but good pizza, and we use coal, which is the difference in the ovens.
So are we gonna exclude the Marino pictures on the walls?
Fortunately, he's the boss. So, I don't know if I can go that far.
I think what sets us apart from a lot of places too, there's no freezer, there's no fryers, there's no microwaves. So it's pretty much like cooking at home, except everyone has a freezer at their house, where we make everything daily and gets cooked daily, so it's really what sets us apart from other locations.
You guys make your own dough on site?
Yep.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. How many stores in the chain?
This will be our 53rd, and we have another one in Westwood, so this will be our second in Mass.
53 in Mass?
53 altogether.
How many in Mass?
This will be number two.
And then the third one in, they'll be opening in Northborough?
Right. A few more months in Northborough, and we have to say Littleton after that.
Okay, anything further from the board? Motion to close the hearing.
Move the Board of Selectmen close the hearing on the alteration of premises for Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza.
Second.
Discussion, all in favor? Motion carries 5-0. Mr. Secretary.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the alteration of premises to include the patio area shown on plan A1.01 for Anthony's Coal Fired Pizza, 48 Walker's Brook Drive.
Second.
Second.
Discussion, all in favor? 5-0. Motion carries. Congratulations.
Welcome to Reading.
Best of luck.
Look forward to seeing you opening. Thank you. Okay. We are now under the FY17 town budget. Bob, do you have some?
Yeah, if I could make some quick opening remarks, I'll give you a sketch of what we're going to do tonight. I have some page numbers. First, Chief Berenz will discuss the fire department budget. That's from your first week of budgets, pages 89 to 93. 97 and 99, and I'll have these up behind me.
Second, Chief Sagala will get to discuss the police and dispatch budgets. That's pages 85 to 88 and 94 to 97. Also part one from your first budget meeting. Again, I'll have that behind me. Then Ruth Urell and the trustees, who I think are meeting down the hall right now, will begin to describe their budget. That's on pages 133 to 136, or part two of the first budget handout. They also have a handout they included that you got over the weekend that I'll also have behind us. And I'll let the trustees describe that at pages 5B1 to 5B14. Just Jeff Sager will describe the DPW budget, pages 100 to 112. I'll quickly go over enterprise funds, 154 to 170, and I'll finish it up with benefits and miscellaneous, 137 to 153. And then next week, on the 26th, the Selectmen will have an agenda item, perhaps a half hour, an hour discussion, whatever you need to wrap this up.
Okay. And tomorrow night is the financial forum.
Tomorrow night is the financial forum, 7:30 at the Pleasant Street Center. Correct.
Thank you. Okay, so who's up first? Is that
Chief Burns?
Fire EMS.
Chief Burns.
We're on 89.
Thanks for having me here tonight. I wanted to start with just give a brief overview of the department, what our responsibilities are. We have four major functions: fire suppression, fire prevention, the emergency medical system, and emergency management. And the department also is responsible to coordinate all reimbursements with state and federal disaster declarations. And we're still working on last year's snowstorms. I just had an email back with our representative from FEMA today. I think they have everything they need. We've had three representatives that we've dealt with the process. So hopefully we'll get it wrapped up within the next few weeks. For emergency response, in calendar year 2015, the department responded to 3,507 emergency calls for assistance. Of these calls, about a little over 2,000 required some level of emergency medical response. And when we look at our reporting to the state for fire responses, we've seen the increase over since calendar year 2014. In 2015, we responded to 38 fires defined as structure fires, 11 fires of mobile equipment, 39 outside fires, in addition to the graph on the next page. Gives you a little bit of a view of what we do, but it kind of is a little misleading because I break down the fire responses and not the EMS responses. For emergency medical responses, our total emergency medical responses have also increased since last year. Last year, we responded to 17 patients that we needed to treat with Narcan due to overdoses. And on the next page, you'll see, basically in general categories, what type of patients we respond to most frequently. You see trauma, medical, psychological emergencies, cardiac, altered neurological status is the highest volumes that we respond to. We bill for our service. We've seen our ambulance revenues increase. Last year, we brought in $784,000 in ambulance billing. The revenue is trending higher than last fiscal year. That's due to the increases in the ambulance fees. In 2014, we collected $616,000. In emergency management, the primary goal for emergency management is to identify areas of vulnerability to the community, prepare for disasters, whether natural or man-made, and to coordinate a response. The secondary goal is to ensure the town's ready and is in compliance with all federal and state requirements so we can recover for losses. Since 2001, we've seen an increase in storm events that have become eligible for reimbursement for federal disaster declarations. And to get that, it has to be a record breaker in some manner. So if it's a snowstorm, it's got to break a record. And generally, it's done by county. So we're fortunate here in Reading that we're in Middlesex County, because our Linfield, who's in Essex County, has not gotten some disaster declarations, because Middlesex is the largest, and for some reason we've got hit harder by some of these storms. So we've benefited by that. So since 2001, we've recovered $1,221,528 in reimbursements for response and damage to our infrastructure. When you take a look at the graph on the next page, most of them are for snow, but if you take a look at 2006 and 2010, we had some damage to town buildings for due to floods. So we were able to recover the damage to both the buildings, carpeting, you know, infrastructure to the buildings. Yes?
When we get the FEMA reimbursement, does that just go right to free cash, or does some of it go?
Yep.
Right to free cash.
Chief, great write-up. Just issue done for the ambulance and reimbursement and FEMA
reimbursement. It'd be helpful for the activity comments before it, the emergency responses and medical responses, to have some sort of trending over the last 5 years. I'd let you decide what you want to show, but some way to show that the deliverable is increasing, as well as the revenues or the recovery of expenses is increasing. You got a great shot of last year. I'm just curious, was last year an anomaly? In the grand scheme of things, is there a generalized trend, either due to increase in population, differences in the demographics, any one of a number of...
I can get that too.
Maybe nothing there, but next year, maybe that, sure, that would be helpful to include.
Sure.
Just trending, because...
Of our EMS responses in general?
What are the major categories of EMS response? What are the major activities that the fire and safety has been asked to do each year, in any category breakdown you choose to make?
Okay.
Probably just by largest, next largest, et cetera. And just, is there anything we can learn from that that's telling? You know, you talked about Narcan doses delivered. That might be an interesting thing to break out. What was it 5 years ago? What was it last year? What, you know, what were you forecasting as a way to do it for next year?
Sure. Okay, I can take a look at that.
It's the same reason you've got the financials in here, to kind of look at trending. It's no more scientific than that.
Yes, I understand.
Thanks.
One of the things we have done, we've started a new program two years ago. We have what's called a SAFE program, that we go into the schools and we teach the Learn Not to Burn program, Stop, Drop, and Roll, you know, how to escape from the house and things. The state enlarged that to educate the senior population, because they're most at risk for falls in the home, and also injuries due to fires, cooking accidents, and things like that. So Lieutenant Mark Dwyer is headed up that program. And he's gone out to the community and delivered programs at the senior center. He's gone out to residents, make sure they have the right smoke detectors in their homes and things. So we've looked at state data, know that that's a population at risk, and we've accessed some funds to enable us to do that. But he's even gone to the to Wakefield, to a men's club in Wakefield, because there was a high percentage of Reading retired men that went there. So so he's been very aggressive with it, which
it
is great.
South, because it's warmer there.
But I'll include that the next time, and I have data that I can take a look and crunch down for you.
Yeah, Chief, real quick, just to touch back on the ambulance services, the fee increase that we did in 2014. If I recall correctly, that was to get us even just at the middle of the road as far as what other communities are charging.
Even the middle.
Right?
You were going to end up a slight bit below median.
Okay.
And the objective was, if to add in the ballpark of 75 or 80,000 for an assistant chief, or maybe it was a little bit more, 90,000 for an assistant chief. It's done a lot more than that. I suspect the volume of calls is a big reason.
Okay.
Not just the price, but you know, as of I think that was 2 years ago, Reading was slightly below average.
Right, and that was
from quite a bit below average.
Yeah. 2 years ago, or where we put it now, is slightly below average.
2 years ago.
2 years ago. So now we're just right around average. Is that
probably still below.
Probably still below.
Would have to think, yeah.
Okay. And for the most part, are these billing cycles, are these direct billings to insurance companies or to individuals? For the most part, do you know? Like,
both.
The
some, you know, one of the things that we have seen is, you know, people's plans change, and some folks have insurance that there's a higher deductible for them, so they're responsible for, you know, more of a portion than other insurance carriers would provide.
Okay.
We haven't had too many requests for hardship, but, you know, we do occasionally get that.
Yeah.
And the thing is with the ambulance billing, we know that our runs are increasing all the time, our transports are increasing all the time, but one of the things that you don't know is what level that patient's going to be treated at. If they're treated at the advanced life support level, it's a more expensive bill than at the basic life support.
Sure.
So, you know, our mix generally runs around 60-40 or so, ALS being the 60%, 40, but that fluctuates from year to year.
Okay.
But it's right around that level. That can impact revenues a little bit as well.
Okay.
So,
do you still feel that the fees where we are right now, are they sufficient? Do you feel like, you know, the increase would be better in the future for them?
I would have to go back and check with our with the same group that we surveyed before, and take a look at it. And it's something that you really need to look at the communities and look and see where we are, and then, you know, what your comfort level is with that.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bob, just a quick question on the munis headings here. The ladder, there's a total of seven columns. Columns 4, 5, and 6, I assume, pertain to the current fiscal year 16.
Let me read them just across the top. You have, I'll start at the right-hand
three
side.
Three prior. All right.
Your projection level 2, that's the budget in front of you. Current year revised budget, so if anything has happened at town meeting. Current year actuals, so that's year to date through the date on the report, which is
fiscal year to
Christmas. Date. Fiscal year to date.
In FY16.
Right.
Okay.
So it should be about half in
most
cases.
Okay, that's 15, 14,
and then
13.
And the prior 3 years.
Okay. Chief, I had a question on the fire chief.
Yes.
So can you explain the jump ups?
I can explain that.
Okay.
That's one of the four positions in the budget that's changing from 37.5 to 40 hours.
Right.
40 hours. So there's fire chief, police chief, DPW director, and town engineer.
Okay. Barry?
Yeah, a couple of things. Did I hear you say that, because I know in the past all the ambulance fee revenue went into free cash. Did I hear say that part of this now is earmarked toward?
It all goes to free cash.
Okay. Does it make sense to look at using some of that to come back into the fire department for other things?
I don't know. Our town accountant's back there. Yeah. There's two ways to do it, and I'm not sure the legality of the one Sharon might address, but. You know, within our budget process, we'd have flexibility for that. And that's a discussion past boards have had for probably 15 or 20 years. And I would say that where it's particularly relevant is if the ALS has an increase in supplies, let's say it's another $25,000, it seems to make sense that in our budget process, we call that an accommodated cost. We can argue that it comes out of ambulance fee revenues quite easily. And so Greg gets a boost of $25,000 in expenses to run the program. So,
which
you know,
is
in an informal way, we can do what you're suggesting, and then there's the formal way. I don't know, Sharon, is that you want to set it up as a revolving fund?
Yeah, a revolving fund to pay for the funds to run the ambulance. And then so the revenues fund whoever works on that, you know, EMTs and such. But I don't know if the cost of running it, if the revenues would cover it. I'm not privy to all that data, but. I mean, I think the way it's currently working, I don't know if it all goes to free cash. Ooh, jeez.
That's the governor.
I don't know if it all goes to free cash, because isn't part of it in our miscellaneous revenue projection?
Oh, it goes to revenues, but it doesn't
go to
his budget.
It goes to revenues, but
it doesn't go
to his budget specifically. It kind of goes in our overall general fund revenues, which is what our real estate tax is. It's just kind of put in the pool of all the revenues, and then he's allocated everything he needs to run.
Because, I mean, there is a cost of running that program, which is generating revenue.
Absolutely.
You know, similarly to, you know, what the schools do for all-day kindergarten, you assign a percentage of that back. The other thing I thought about, maybe a potential use, or maybe it's a separate discussion, is, you know, in the past, you know, there's been a wide fluctuation in the overtime. I think you were looking at sort of changing the groupings, and you know, maybe this can kind of help sort of ease that, where we, you know, you get a huge overtime blip, where this can kind of you know, ease that a little bit or even that out. So I don't know if that's, if overtime is still going to be an ongoing issue, or if the groups have been organized in a way that kind of, you know, takes care of that.
I did take a look at the overtime budget, and we're trending just $2,000 less than last year's. And one of the things is that we hired four new firefighters in May, and we trained them in-house in May, and we had them up and counted as part of our shift strength in June. But the fire academy slots came available in July, so I sent two in July. And then I sent two more in
September?
Yeah, at the end of September. During that period that we were sent them off to the academy and had use of them, I had three firefighters who were out injured. So what I saw was, in the overtime, when I looked at it by pay period, comparing fiscal years, that July, the mid-July was trending lower at overtime expenditures this fiscal year than last. When they went off to the academy, it went up. When they came back from their training and the three firefighters came back from injury, I saw the overtime drop down. And so now we're trending lower than last fiscal year. But because we were paying the new firefighters and had them out during peak vacation period when we had some injuries, that really used up a lot of our overtime budget. So now we're still down a position. We had a firefighter resign to pursue a medical education in July, and so we're down a position, and we're training those positions and had those injuries. So that kind of hit us hard this year.
Did you expect, as you enter next year, that the increased labor resource you'd see a definite impact in reduced overtime because you've got more of that's going to be paid at regular hours rather than overtime?
That's correct. I am projecting that we'll have between two and three new firefighters. We have, if we hire an internal person for the assistant chief's position, that's going to create a vacancy. I know I have one vacancy right now, and I have a captain that's going to retire in December. So we'll have to, time these hires to, fill this before it starts costing us extra overtime.
Okay. Well, to perhaps some of your points, Barry's especially, offhand, there's $750,000 coming in revenues. The way our budget model works, roughly two-thirds, one-third split. One could argue that we have costs that could be covered, but I just figure it works out in the wash. But, absolutely there are costs that need to be covered, and those costs are increasing because we're about half and half, maybe a little bit more than that, in ALS certified firefighters now, and we only hire ALS certified firefighters. So at some point we'll be 100%, and ALS firefighters are more expensive than BLS firefighters. So I've done all the math in collective bargaining. There's an increasing cost for a number of years until we hit that point of full staffing, in addition to the fact that you have more firefighters probably to offer the service. So there is a cost. It's not quite a black and white cost, but it's a significant cost. And as I mentioned last week, our public safety budget is about average for our peers. But if you factor in the fact that only 11 out of 25 run ALS, some portion of our costs are because we also derive revenues from them. So if you really wanted to push the envelope with math, you could do that. But I'm not sure where you'd go.
Yeah, because I know in the past we looked at sort of like, oh, this is great. It's bringing revenue into the town. We're also providing an incredible service that a lot of our peer communities don't.
Point,
and that's
right.
Obviously the main point of doing it. But, recognize that there's a cost to providing that. We could not do it.
Yeah.
Right? And our costs will be down. So I think it's important to recognize what those delta costs are and to at least cover those costs with the revenue. And then the rest gets divided the way we might normally do.
It ought to be cost neutral at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Bob, can you remind me where the revenues flow into the budget? Do they come into the, what fund do they get posted to?
What are these ones called? Other?
They're under miscellaneous.
So all of the ambulance billings come in through, because I thought I heard moments ago it was posted to free cash.
Well, it closes the end of the year and becomes part of free cash.
Oh, okay, now I understand, thank you.
Yeah, Mark.
Thank you. Just a question following up on Barry and Kevin's comments. Is it possible to take a look at where we stand now in terms of how much we charge for the service and to kind of make sure we understand where we are and if that's the place we really want to be? I think it was discussed. I wasn't sure if it was resolved, how we deal with it.
To look at the ambulance revenues compared to other communities? Yes, we can take a look at that. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah, if you could do that by middle of March for FinCom, probably.
Sure.
Mark, so you know, we did that 2 years ago and made a quantum leap.
Yes.
So this is probably, if there is a jump to be made, it's likely to be much smaller than that 2 years ago.
Okay.
Anything else? No, we increased some expenses. Our ALS medical expenses are going up because of the cost of disposables and what our costs are to actually purchase the supplies and also uniforms as well. And then the non-union, the union, the raises for the firefighters by the union contract.
Right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chief.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Chief Segal.
Thanks, Greg.
Pipe and drum guys are outside if you'd like to sit down tonight. They're all set. I'm going to take them everywhere I go.
All right.
It'd be tough to top that last. Good evening. I thought I'd start with just giving you a little bit of my vision for the future and some of my goals I have going forward for the department. I just thought I'd give you a couple minutes on that for us. So my vision is pretty simple. I want to provide the highest quality police services to our residents. I want to make us the most cohesive police, community policing department around. I think some areas that we could improve on, some of our community policing efforts. I met with all the supervisors as a whole 2 weeks ago. On a Wednesday night, I had them all for one night together. And I've gone over the last 2 weeks and I've met with every roll call, so every officer I've been in front of to pitch my goals to them. So long story short, what I wanted, one of the things I wanted to do, as you saw last week, was we had the honor guard there. This is a community policing thing. We haven't had an honor guard for a while in the town of Reading, but I put a kind of one together with those officers that were there last week from guys that were on it years ago. And I want to do is make a more permanent one going forward. For Memorial Day, for Veterans Day services, I want to be able to have an honor guard there from the police department. I want us to be representing ourselves to the public. I'm also going to reinstitute the Citizens Police Academy, hopefully by September. I want to have that going forward to be able to run. I'd like to run two a year, but I'd like to start with one. We'll see how we can do. Minimum of, you know, going forward, though, I'd like to start next year, try to have two in place, because I think that was something that was a great tool. We had a lot of selectmen years ago go through it, and I think it was a great tool, you know, for the public to see what we do behind the scenes.
Yeah.
You know? Let's see. The RAD program's coming back. We haven't had that in a while. I know we're going to have a class hopefully by the early part of the spring going forward, too. Let's see. We're in the process of hiring two officers right now. Matter of fact, we're doing a lot of interviews on Thursday, and we have there's an academy starting mid-March right here in Reading, so we're trying to get two people for that academy coming up. Let's see. Okay, so that's basically my basic just going forward. I want
coffee with the cops.
I'll tell you. So here's.
I remember that from your.
Here's what I have on here about that. This is my last thing. Is the community service officer right now works a 4-on-4 schedule. Actually, he just retired, Jimmy Collins, last week. So I'm filling the community service officer position on an admin type of position. And that person is going to be the liaison to the businesses of town. Which I think really right now we have the safety officer doing it. And it's kind of, quite honestly, it's a lot for him doing everything. He's also going to be the liaison with the Fall Street Fair, the Christmas lighting, Town Day. An open house, that's the other thing I want to have every year now going forward, is an open house. We haven't had one in a while, and I know that was something to bring the public in on a Saturday for a couple hours. We open up the doors, allow everybody to take a look at what we do.
Bad kids can spend an hour in jail.
We can talk.
Sell tickets.
And that's what I have on here, is the coffee with a co-op too. I'd like to have at least once a month, having something to do, you know, maybe pick a different business once a month, see if we can get them to talk as well, donate the coffee, and have the public come in and meet and greet, so. Okay.
Chief, any thought to getting some of that captured with the RCTV to the extent, you know, it's got kind of a lasting effect?
Absolutely, yeah, that would be great, absolutely, absolutely. I can definitely talk to them about that. Feels great to work with, so. All right, on to the budget, I guess.
What page do we have?
Page 85 from your first packet.
The first thing, I was actually gonna go to the last page of my budget. They would have the Reading Police stats from the last 3 years. Just to show you, I had all the...
That's 87.
Sorry. I had all the stats pulled from 2013, 14, and 15. Just to show you the trend of, it's pretty steady for the most part. We have a couple that have trended down, actually. But calls for service are around 20,000 to 21,000. Arrests are pretty close, 135 adults last year. Hearings last year was a little lower, 224. Protective custodies due to alcohol was 45. Written citations, that's motor vehicle citations, a little over 4,000 last year. Motor vehicle crashes is fairly steady, 528. Dispatch log entries are around, actually declined a little bit last year, almost 31,000. They gave out over 4,000 access tickets. Parking citations to 1,947, and the generation was 42,000, almost 43,000 in money generated. In detective investigations, which are any major investigations from assault and battery dangerous weapons to burglaries to if there was a homicide, anything like that, we had 138 detective investigations last year.
Two quick questions. How long, what's a typical investigation duration? I know they're all over the map. But
so they can range from a couple days to it could range to quite honestly, it could range to up to 30 days, you know, before they close it out, depending upon what type of an investigation it is. And an average detective has 7 to 9 cases open at a time out of the 6 detectives that we have.
And then the second question on the cash generation, is that principally parking citations?
Yes, yes, that is for the parking, yeah, that's directly for the parking citations.
Okay,
all right, if you want to go back to page 85, I guess in your handout. Okay, the Reading Police Department budget request for FY17 is requested at a little over $5.3 million. That's about a 4.4% compared to FY16. Over 95% of this budget is spent on personnel. In FY17, the budget request the police department budget for 42 sworn officers. This is the same amount of officers as we had in FY16. 2 civilian office employees, civilian part-time parking enforcement officer, and 1 full-time and 1 part-time position with ARCASA. ARCASA positions that will show in the police department budget are fully grant-funded positions for FY17. The salary lines are meeting all contractual agreements and direction regarding non-union compensation. This would include steps and COLA adjustments. There was a request for an additional SRO in my level 1 budget. The request was removed at the town manager level, but should be considered for future budgets. Since its inception in 2006, the SRO program has seen the request for assistance from schools, parents, students steadily increase. There have been notable increases in calls for assistance with students dealing with numerous mental health issues. The SRO is now certified as of last year as an instructor of youth mental health first aid for the district. As an instructor, the SRO is teaching school personnel on all levels how to help an adolescent who is experiencing a mental health challenge or addiction challenge or is in crisis. The course introduces common mental health challenges, outlines typical adolescent development, and teaches a 5-step action plan of how to help a youth who's in crisis. The SRO has received an increase in requests for assistance from area secondary schools of all grade levels, including preschools. With additional time and resources, we expect the SRO position to become less restrictive and more proactive. This will allow the SRO to be more visible and spend more time being interactive with students, building their trust and acceptance as part of the school community. Examples of some of the tasks the SRO executes each day are consulting with school staff, meeting with students and parents, investigations, 51A filings, safety plans, and reentry meetings, speaking with the court representatives up in Lowell and attending court hearings. Since the first day of school of this past September, the SRO has assisted the schools with 173 documented incidents. It should be noted that oftentimes the SRO is involved with student, parent, staff, which do not require true documentation. These types of incidents include phone calls, speaking with students that stopped by the SRO office or attending school-sponsored events. The expenses are up to 7.4% over last year. Department expense budget, we are currently under negotiation with the town of North Reading to regionalize the animal control officer functions. There, as you'll see in the budget, there was a $50,000 set aside to fund that regionalization. Excuse me. The police training budget request of $17,000 is to right side the line due to the current cost of training. Over the past 3 years, the average cost of of training has been $18,500. It's vital that we keep our officers up to date with law changes and current police techniques. Some of the adjustments to the other categories have been made in an attempt to currently accurately predict costs. Okay. Are there any questions so far on the police budget?
It might be a silly question. Do you see, in your wildest imagination, any other opportunities to regionalize besides animal control?
Actually, we've had that discussion recently, and
we were thinking of the chief a year.
Seriously.
No, I said, yeah. I think
our CASA is ripe for that, and area towns that don't have it have discussed it with us. Where it's grant-funded right now, it's not a financial issue. But drugs obviously don't stop at the borders.
Dispatch was another one we talked about.
Dispatch was a big effort. Didn't go very far.
Right.
And I'll be honest with you, animal control is quite an effort just to get that done. You know, if it's not done by a town meeting, we'll just abandon it. And it's, you know, not complete yet with just North Reading.
Yep. Thank you.
Chief, real quick, the SRO program sort of instituted in 2006, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just really more of a sense from you. Obviously, the more programs, the longer these programs stay around, the more active they are, the more responses go up. I always had the question, are the responses going up because people are more aware of it, or responses going up because there's a need for those responses?
I think it's both. I think years ago, we didn't have the trust of the schools like we do now.
Yeah.
I'll be honest. I think now we work so well with the schools department in general that they'll call Mike Buell on everything and anything, which is good. I'd rather be involved early than to find out something happened and they didn't call us on, you know. But I think when it first started, it was very difficult, you know, because they weren't sure how we were going to react, you know. And I think now we really let them, we guide them more than tell them what to do, you know, in a lot of incidents. But they're very, very good at working with all three of our past SROs. And, you know, I think that's it's a little bit of both, I think.
Yeah.
Chief, if you got the extra SRO officer that was in your budget, would you envision just timesing by two what the current SRO officer does? Or would you, what kind of, you know, additional kind of services or things that the SRO do that you can't do just when you have one person?
Sure. I would think, my envision would be is that we'd use that person a lot more in the middle schools. And I think that's what we lack right now is we spend a lot of time in the high school. And, you know, some time in the middle in elementary schools, but I think we could use a lot more interaction with the middle schools and the elementary schools on a more daily basis than we do now. Now it's kind of triaging, and I think we're really reactive sometimes with some of the other schools than we are with the high school. You know, we spend, like I said, I would say probably 75-80% of his time is at the high school.
And that actually kind of dovetails with like some of the survey, the risk survey that came in. There's a lot of stuff in the middle school that's not potentially being addressed.
Right.
Or the activity started at a younger age.
Right,
that
right. So that's where I would see the person working more with the middle schools. You know, obviously the elementary school, but I think the middle is where I'd really like to see them targeted.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Chief, kind of the same question I asked Chief Burns. Obviously on an anonymous basis, I'd be curious to get this kind of SRO data presented just in terms of activity-based data over time, because it's a window into what you guys are seeing.
Sure.
And both the youth, it complements the youth risk assessment, it gives us some context to understand our CASA.
Yeah, absolutely.
The world's changing, right? And you guys are probably the tip of the spear in terms of realizing what's happening tomorrow. Right?
Right, right.
And so being able to look at that with some context would be really useful.
Absolutely. Okay, I can do that. I'll decide.
In any categorization you see fit.
Right, because I'll speak with all three of the former and the current SRO to see what they think the best way going forward would be as well from their point of view, and I'll have, I can get that data for you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions?
I have one. It seems like there's only one thing missing that you really wanted, and that's the SRO.
Yeah, it would be nice to have the additional officer that would be in the schools.
Well, you know, I'll tell you something, Chief. The item that you brought up about the absence of proactivity at our lower levels, I think is really something that we all have to think of long and hard. I understand that financially, sometimes decisions have to be made about, and we're not talking about cutting one, we're talking about not adding one. And sometimes it's a little easier to say, well, we'll do that next year. But, you know, the impact here could be a life. I mean, and you know, I think it's important for us to begin to quantify what the absence of revenue is potentially costing us. You know, I mean, I think you really make a very good point that, you know, we currently have SROs who, past and present, who have made enormous inroads. I mean, that's so clear. And, you know, your description of how Mike is currently interacting with the schools is kind of very encouraging, actually. The fact that we are proactively involved at the high school level when, in some cases, the die is cast, and reactively being involved at the middle school level when maybe we'd have an option to help somebody make a turn in the correct direction instead of in the incorrect direction. I think we just really need to continue to quantify the absence of these requests. You know, I think I had this discussion with Joe last week about what we're missing. And I think it's really important that don't let it get lost in the shuffle of, oh, it's just a budget discussion. We're really talking about kids' lives here.
Right. Thank you.
Okay, Mark?
Chief and Bob, the Fed grant support line drops quite a bit, so I assume that's the end of some grant that we have. Can you talk a little bit about what that grant is, and also if there's some other opportunities we might chase out?
There's always other opportunities. I think that one is an alcohol grant that expires. It's not the big CASA grant. I believe within the police budget there were three grants today currently in force, and there'll only be two next year, and then drop to the one big CASA grant. So the philosophy broadly has been put in a resource that pays for itself. A year from now, absent any other discussions, we're probably going to have that discussion about the resource we have is no longer fully funded by the grant. Is it worth having an incremental cost of $20,000 or whatever it might be? So there is one position, I think it's the youth coordinator, that's eliminated next year because the grant expires. And just to remind everyone, the grants run October 1 to September 30th, so it's not a perfect match.
Further questions? Okay, dispatch?
Dispatch. Okay, the public safety request for FY17 is funded at $565,150, a 5.3% increase compared to FY16. Over 95% of this budget as well is spent on personnel. Dispatch currently staffed with 10 civilian telecommunicators and one civilian head dispatcher who work several shifts per week as a telecommunicator and oversees the administration of the dispatch center. In addition to town funding, $50,000 in a 911 grid funds are used to offset existing salaries. This grant is not guaranteed and can be discontinued starting the new fiscal cycle. Salary lines are meeting all contractual agreements with direction regarding non-union compensation. This would include steps and COLA adjustments. Each year, the field becomes more complex due to changes in technology and in emergency medical dispatch requirements. The Reading Dispatch Center is in compliance with all requirements. And expenses is up 2.6%. Dispatch has gone through some major changes in staffing over the past few years. In addition, the town has increased the overall staffing levels. This has caused an increase in initial uniform and training costs. That's basic.
How would you say the additional telecommunicators have helped?
Outstanding. I think it's one of the best things we did was add a couple extra people for having. Now we have coverage, basically two people on 24 hours a day. We're not backfilling all the time when someone takes a shift off on a midnight in there, but quite honestly, it's been going very well.
Questions.
Chief, was there a line item in the capital budget? I can't remember. You had talked about sort of upgrading
the dispatch equipment itself, and that it's become really.
Yeah, that was.
I was thinking of that too.
I don't know if we put it in yet, but Chief Coyman, when we came in and spoke to you back last month, two months ago.
Something about that, yeah.
Yeah, we said that we have to think about a $500,000, $400,000 to $500,000 project sometime as a capital improvement plan going forward with dispatch. Dispatch is still working in the same cabinets that we had 16 years ago, which weren't new, which we got from back then when they built the new building. Came in for some of them from, were donated, and some came from other, from the old station. So they really need to, equipment is changing, and things don't even fit the way they were supposed to in those cabinets, because quite honestly, television and everything else have changed sizes, and everything's done now on screens, not on these big, huge computers anymore for dispatch.
I can answer. It's currently in the capital plan, but it's listed in FY21, so that's 4 years from now, $500,000.
Yeah, I think the total of that discussion was, because I was taking copious notes that night, I think the capital needs were slightly over $1 million all in, and where one of them was. So, I mean, that stuff is all looming on our horizon.
Right.
Yep. As I remember that discussion, and you can tell me my recall is incorrect. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. It didn't seem like there was much in there that was, wouldn't it be nice?
Right.
I think it was, these are things we must do over the course of time in order to stay, keep public safety at a high level.
Right, and it could be, some of it could become an unfunded mandate as well, depending on what happens with body cameras going forward.
Yeah.
Right. And body cameras and that kind of technology is not in any budget presently.
No, but it was in that discussion.
Absolutely.
And, yep. You know, I thought it was aptly pointed out that that mandate is probably one incident away
from
turning into a mandate.
So
thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mark.
Okay. We'll be on to the library. Ruth?
Hi.
Hello.
I'd like to introduce our trustees in the back, please, and our finance committee liaison, who's been very helpful to us this budget season, Vanessa Alvarado, and David Hutchinson, whom you know as chair of the building committee as well, Alice Holland, Chair Dubois, and the library assistant director, Amy Lannan, and our current chair, Vicki Yablonski. Thank you for letting us have a few minutes. And you should have received a long poetic narrative in your packets, but I did pull out some summary sheets. I thought it might be easy to sort of see things at a glance and study them a little bit while we look at them. So we have no shortage of reading material.
Thank you.
As you might expect.
No pun intended.
Completely intended. Completely. Yeah. So, I actually had asked Vicki to start, and then I jumped the gun. Sorry, Vicki.
Thank you for listening to us. This is, I know it's a tough year coming up budget-wise, but it's a difficult one for us, too, because we are facing going into a new library, hopefully this summer, a bigger, expanded library, and at the same time, we've just completed our five-year planning process. And part of what you got in your packet was the executive summary. And I think earlier may have received the whole new plan of service for the 5 years. So we are trying to move back into the building and implement the plan at the same time. And we're looking to build back up to, we had a few areas that were, budget was reduced when we went into our temporary quarters. So we're trying to bring those back up to where they were before we moved, and to provide the staff and services that we need to implement the plan of service. We had a great response from the community survey, and we think we have a very good plan. And part of what you're going to see is some of this starting for next year. And then there are a couple of lines where you asked us to project out a couple of years in phasing in the plan and in the building. But I think we're just really going to concentrate, of course, on next year's budget.
Thank you. So I would like to draw your attention to the second page, which has the plan of service executive summary and the six kind of key directions that we're hoping to go in that are particular focus and emphasis on. And the first is access to educational programs and materials with an emphasis on early literacy. And if you look on your services and programs sheet, you will see that last year we had 9,000 children come to early literacy programs, and we were open for access year-round 3,032 hours, 330 days. So those are kind of core services that we're offering, and we're continuing to focus on that particular group because it is a unique niche for the public library. And both locally, in the responses that we got to our planning survey this year, we had 1,200 people respond to the survey, and it was clear priority for the Reading community, as well as it has been shown to be a national priority across the board when the Pew Internet Research Group has done any research for the roles of public libraries. So that's a strong program that we offer year-round. And the next is the support lifelong education for adults. This is a growing part of our services, and last year 3,180 adults attended programs, and the demand for programs is consistently high, and people are asking for more all the time. I tried to bring some ideas and examples of some of the kinds of programs that we're doing, and an indication of the range. So, for example, we have two Harry Potter events for teens in our current offerings, and we have our popular winter warmers on Friday evening this week, always advertising, where we do the book reviews, and we generally have about 80 people come to our librarian-led book reviews. It's kind of speed dating with the librarians. The early literacy story
I'm not sure you can
is,
say that.
She tried to sneak that.
Everyone's invited.
Okay.
Everyone's invited. Early literacy story times, I can't even begin to list them. They're just a long list of literacy story times. And then we're offering something new, trying to attract the young professionals with this new program called Pints and Pages. We have partnered with the Wilmington Library to have book discussions for sort of young adults, and rotate them between off-site, between Reading and locations in Wilmington. Our usual book groups, literary lunches, the kids come on a Saturday, they talk about books they've been reading and enjoying, and they have pizza. It can be very lively. They like to get into quite the heated discussions about it. So those are some of the kinds of traditional programs. And as well, a lot of our daily bread and butter is actually, I'm going to pass these around because I think this is real, real important to emphasize, that the kinds of content that we have is so much more than books. And Amy was looking today at the statistics, and we're guessing that we have over 50,000 e-books at this point that are somewhat invisible unless you are kind of in the know. So people come into the library with their gadgets and their different types of devices, or they borrow them from us, and the librarians are helping people to figure out how to download books, how to download music and movies and so on. So,
Ruth, a bunch of questions.
Yeah.
Let me take them in order. 3,000 visits by youth. Do you distinguish between group kids that come as a member of a class or a group versus kids that might come with their parents? Do you make a distinction in that number?
So they get, it's a head count.
Sure.
So the programs, I can tell you that the number of early literacy programs were 220 programs.
My question is only when you say 3,000, it would make a difference to me if it was a 30 groups of 30.
Uh-huh, sure.
Versus
right.
900 independent families coming
sure.
in.
Yep.
That's more an indication of
yep.
voting with your feet rather than coming along with the class. Do you keep the statistics that way?
We keep them every which way. It's quite remarkable how much we can drill down, and I can probably get you a more concise answer.
Just going forward,
yep.
that might be interested.
Sure.
Secondly, you talked about young adults. What is a young adult?
So, a lot of libraries call young adults sort of teens and up. In this context, I'm referring to 20s and 30-somethings.
Okay.
Okay.
That's nice to hear that they're still young at 30.
Yeah.
It's been a long time for you.
They're not Dutch. The opening page, I mentioned this to the chiefs in terms of trending. The
mm-hmm.
subject in the anything to do with finances would be really helpful to have maybe 3 years lagging and 3 years leading, only because I know we've got it buried in here in terms of current calendar year and year minus, but anything that you represent,
sure.
just for context, it's
sure.
useful to see
yep.
Both either dollars or full-time equivalents from a trending point
sure.
of view.
Yep.
There was one other question in there, but it slipped my mind.
I'll play off that. In terms of your three-year forecast,
yeah.
how would you characterize that?
So I'd love to talk about that. Would you like me to start talking about it?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. So like to emphasize this evening, of course, year one, and that obviously the request is the second column in that cover page of what I just passed out. So the first column is the manager's recommendation, and the second column is the request that we have submitted. And the major points on that are to, and I put those into the detail which you would have received in the narrative on pages 4, 5, and 6. I don't know what pages they are in your
here?
Packet. That's it. Yes, thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
So 5B4 and 5B5.
I'm happy to walk through that. I think that the library is truly at a pivotal point. This is an extraordinary time for us, and we have figured out how we can succeed in the new library and really rethought a lot of our services and a lot of our staffing structure. So we believe that we need to maintain our current leadership and maintain our current staffing levels and structures as they are as we make this transition in the first year. So that is the first part of the recommendation. And we're looking to upgrade our librarians. Our librarians are 10 of our staff members are librarians. Our librarians have MLS degrees. They're not associates. They're not supervised. Well, in some instances, they supervise, but that is their rank, is what I'm trying to say. They're currently ranked at grade E, and they are definitely outperforming that. And that needs to be addressed, and that is a $6,700 difference and an $11,000 difference, so about $18,000 for that.
Ruth, do you know, I don't know, how we rank relative to the ratio of full librarians to others relative to peers? Is that are we at? At the average, are we above or below?
The peers in Reading or the peers in other communities?
Our surrounding towns, similar sized towns.
Yeah,
I think he means how many librarians.
How many librarians, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
I'd have to look that number up. I can get that number from the Mass Board of Library Commissioners data, but I would have to look that up. They don't print those reports anymore. So
I understand. One of the things we're worried about things like cost and deliverables, and one of the things you worry about is comparables.
Uh-huh.
The only thing that we can gauge is, are we doing a good job? And then relative to how others do it, are we on a comparable basis
uh-huh.
in terms of expense or the intensity of the work, or are we have extraordinarily different circumstances? So I have no way to know if 11 is right or it's wrong, or
uh-huh.
it's high or it's low. And so anytime you provide a number, it's helpful to give it some context by
sure.
comparables, because
yeah.
at least in this subject matter, I have no idea whether
yeah.
that's a great number or a good number or an average number.
Right. There's only one who
yeah.
is full-time, so the full-time equivalent of that is, I'd also have to look up that number. So the second piece of this is the digital services manager. We've brought this position before you a couple of times in previous years,
It's an important component of our service and an increasingly complex area of work. At this point, we really need to have someone who can provide us with both leadership direction and also staff training, as well as kind of public instruction and public classes. And that is a key position for us, this increasing amount of digital content, and the other traditional services are not going away.
When you say public training, what kind of training do you mean?
So we have classes in all kinds of computer skills. We have classes on evaluating information resources, online information resources. We have internet privacy kinds of classes, all kinds of both hands-on and theoretical instruction.
Would some of that be done by third parties, perhaps under under contract, or perhaps even on a nominal fee-based? In other words, that deliverable alone, there's plenty of people that have that skill and walking on the street. Is that something you might consider filling, not with a full-time, but with somebody you might bring in on a contract basis and then try to get reimbursement for the from the attendees?
Oh, well, we don't charge for library programs, so we wouldn't be looking for reimbursement for us.
Is that a policy, or is that just a practice?
No, that's a policy. Yeah, that's a policy. It's integrated also into the daily work. This is a continuous kind of demand and a continuous kind of, I brought a couple of examples this evening to show this is a position that would also be evaluating some of the resources. For example, I passed around the handout that describes some of our online Mango,
yep.
For example, a language learning resource. We're looking at loading apps all the time onto iPads for children to use when they're there. We have preschool apps. We have electronic resources for school-age children and adults, and trying to evaluate those, compare them, enter contracts, because, of course, a lot of those are leased. It's a pretty complicated specialization. The last piece of the budget request is asking for an additional $5,877 for substitutes, so that our public service desks can be covered when people are absent, or they can be somewhat covered when people are absent. We're particularly concerned about this as we're going into a new building that is larger, and we will have a service desk on our lower level in the new building. So that's a particularly important year to fully cover that. The only other difference between the request and the town manager's recommendation is in the books line, and that is a difference of $22,000. Our request is for 15% of the total, and the manager's recommendation is 14.5%. So I would like, if you can pull out those charts, I think I gave you those as part of your packet, and talk about the trend over the 3 years that we have forecast. Whether you look at the pie chart or the line graph, I think you'll see that we're moving from year one, combined 30% of expenses in administration and circulation, to year three, getting that down to 26% of the total budget, and adding the resources to children's services, reference services, adding Thursdays and adding Sundays in, so really directly benefiting the public and having quite enhanced services there in the course of 3 years. We think that some of our technology and our automated materials handling will take a year or two for us to start to see some staffing benefit.
Well, the reality, I realize what this is. Your consultant did a lot of good work. They came back, they took a hard look at your growth areas, I would characterize what you're saying as, this is your wish list. If you could fund everything you wanted to, this is what you would fund. And your budgets are increasing at a rate of between 8% and 10% a year, as I see them here. That's not sustainable, Ruth. We all know that.
Mm-hmm.
How are you going to go about prioritizing what the consultant has recommended to fit within whatever budget constraints we're going to have? It's not going to be 8 to 10, I'll tell you that.
Right.
And we all know that.
Right. No, I understand the percentage is very difficult, and
yes.
The reality is that with a smaller budget, we'll never be able to add a position if we are never able to change the percent. So we're asking for a position this year to help us manage our move-in, and that right away takes us way over the 3% recommendation. I mean, that's just a factor of having a small budget.
Right.
So if we completely, I mean, if you look at the numbers we're asking for in the following year, we're asking for a half-time children's librarian.
Solid.
In the third year, we're asking for half-time children's half-time programming librarian. I appreciate that the percent kind of looks tough, but at the same time, as I say, there's...
So how will you reconcile the recommendations with the available budget? Do you have a plan for doing that? You're not going to be able to fulfill everything, but do you have a way of prioritizing, which you absolutely have to have?
Right. So I think that we have recognized that trying to add the Thursdays, we know that there's interest in adding Thursdays, and I think it's more than we can take on with our with all the current change that is going. So I think that is why that has been pushed into the second year, and the extending the Sundays to coincide with the school year and adding an hour to those, we push that back into the third year to try to phase it in a little bit.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead, Dan.
Ruth, one of the things I'm struggling with, Dan's hit one, and year one you're talking for 7.5%, year two you're at 11.7%, and year three you're at 5.8%, that's year on year gains. With all the advancement in technology in the new library, I'm surprised that some of the, obviously wage and salary is not going to get necessarily touched unless you've managed to do it with fewer people. But is there any cost that's reduced through the use of technology in the new library?
Yeah, that's a key question.
Sorry. Here.
Is there any cost, operating cost, in the library that is improved by virtue of all the new technology that we've just spent
right.
and purchased and deployed?
Right.
If so, what is it?
This is, yes. So in year three, you see that we are reducing circulation services by $36,000.
I saw that.
Yeah.
And for those at home, circulation services is labor and wage? Is it a person?
Circulation services is people who are checking books out, yes.
Okay, and what happens in year three that allows it to drop that doesn't also happen in year two or year one?
I'm cautious about year two. Year one, we know that we're going to need our current staffing levels.
Why is that?
They're because we won't be able, we have all new systems to learn, and we have much more complex, for example, our meeting rooms, our conference rooms, all have much more sophisticated AV equipment. Somebody's gonna have to be opening that up, setting it up for night meetings, that kind of thing. Overall, we're going back to a three-level building, so we just need to be sure that we have adequate number of people in the building. I think as self-service and materials handling become more comfortable for people in year two, that's when we can start to see that we might be able to make some savings in that department.
Carrie, then Bob.
This is kind of a, this department I think is, looking at the budget is a little bit different than maybe we look at the others, given the fact that we are gonna have a new building. And that building's gonna come online sometime at the beginning of the next fiscal year. We've spent a lot of money on building that new building. And I think we really need to look hard at how we're going to staff this building. Because the last thing in the world we want to do in terms of a deliverable is building a beautiful new building that doesn't work because we haven't staffed it adequately. Now, the one thing that I would ask, you know, Ruth and the trustees to look at is, you don't yet know really how this building's going to work.
Right.
Right.
And so while it's really good to look at sort of a 3-year outlook, I think the way we look at the library now vis-a-vis other departments, it's harder to do. You just, I mean, you know, you're moving into a new stadium. You know, you don't know where the concessions are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a different thing. And I think that you're going to learn a lot in the first year about maybe what you can get away with, what you can kind of move around before we kind of commit to a long term at a time when it's really hard for the rest of, the rest of the departments. You know, you were here before. You know, we're trying to scrounge one more police officer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's just the pie's not getting that big. But I do appreciate the fact that we have to look at this differently because we don't want to have a situation where we build a library that everybody now is disappointed with because we haven't figured out how to staff it. So the one thing that maybe from my point of view is really just figure out what do you need minimum this year.
Kind of what I was driving at.
Minimum this year. Maybe it's the digital services thing because that's going to have a longer, a longer thing. And then come back next year and sort of figure out, now we've kind of, we felt our oats a little bit, you know, now we know kind of what we need, what we can maybe move around, and then maybe the ask doesn't look so big for year two and three because you figured out a way to kind of get the services done with what you have. So, I mean, in my view, I mean, you had talked about this digital services person even before the library got built, and we knew that it was important, the way libraries are trending, that was an important piece. You know, is that the number one? I mean, if you had to have the one thing, is that the one thing?
Oh, that's definitely the one thing.
Okay. Well, I think Ruth and presumably the trustees have done a really good job in working with the consultant. If I go back to October-ish, their requests at that point are different than they are now because of a lot of things you've said. They realize there is going to be a learning experience as they move into a new building. They're going to have to be flexible. They're going to have to adapt. You know, and they're working with staff that have been in the library a long time. So I certainly appreciate and understand all that. And, you know, an initial request was more Sunday hours, and they realized that's not practical. They need to learn the new building, exactly as you said. One of the real gating items here, though, you know, staffing is a separate discussion, but a real gating item to efficiency is what I always somewhat jokingly refer to as this 15% book tax. Yeah. No matter how efficient you get, you have to spend more.
Yeah.
Wasn't that a state thing?
That's a Prop 2.5 that's not probably relevant today in terms of physical cost of material. You know, and I know there's been some discussion at the state level of changing that percent, lowering that percent. That's a real hindrance to running a library, and it's not necessarily something that trustees or the director would ask for if it weren't a requirement to be certified.
Well, I'm not sure that you wouldn't ask for it.
Well, electronic stuff is much cheaper.
Not necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing else.
It's cheaper to store.
Maybe, but I think that the demand for books and printed materials or CDs or videos or whatever, DVDs, is still high, and I think that we still have a population that is checking those materials out. And
I live with three of them.
You know, to cut back on, to open up a brand new building with, you know, and then cut back on being able to fill that building with new materials that the public is demanding is difficult. And I think that, in my experience, digital resources are not necessarily cheaper.
Right.
Yeah.
Bob's spoken at the same thing I think we all are. It must be that with some of this technology, that some aspect of delivering the service, storage, wear out or attrition, ability for self-help rather than guided help, some of this has to get easier with technology. It just has to.
Well, for example, the materials handling, the automated, as we phase it in, yes, I think the first year, as we've said, it's going to be a whole new complicated system that the staff has to learn and has to train the public, because there will be self-check. And once that's phased in and people become comfortable with that, that's where we see the trend. You know, we're guessing on year two and three what we've given you right now.
That's check out or check in or both?
Both. So that, especially, but self-check would be checking out, that's where we see the decline in the circulation staff going down and maybe being able to redeploy some of those people to other things.
But even something like reference, I'm surprised that in this day and age that there isn't more online self-help type kiosks where some of what used to have to be deployed by subject matter experts to kind of search the various catalogs isn't available in a more electronic form, at least for basic, ordinary kind of requests. Is that not the case?
So our, I think a lot of our business is education. I mean, that's, you know, that's the overall kind of what's going on. And what we're doing is, to a certain degree, it's more complicated because the information is not as easy to find, access, and evaluate. For example, for a student who might have come in 20 years ago and looked something up in the encyclopedia, you pull the volume out, you show them how to use it, you go through the sort of the alphabetical thing. Now, it's not necessarily intuitive to go to, there's this database and this database and this source, and in fact, our librarians are often teaching the teachers about these resources. They're very rich, but they're also fairly complicated, and that is a lot of what we're doing. We're not just about circulating materials. We're also about educating anyone who walks in who is looking for help or direction. A lot of what goes on is working, of course, a lot of it is working with children and students, but it's also working with parents quite a bit about children's reading and guiding. And the same thing for self-directed adults. We're sort of helping. We get a lot of asks for assistance with our public computers, public computing. I mean, that's a big part of our business is people who don't have resources elsewhere or who prefer the library's resources are sometimes needing help with simple things and sometimes more complicated things. Can you help me set up an email account, for example? So I do agree that we can't forecast exactly when we'll start to see some savings in our circulation services, but I do think that we will certainly by year three be able to make a judgment about that. I think the first year or two we're going to be learning ourselves and helping people to learn how to use these new things. In addition to that, our Board of Library Commissioners reports that most communities that open a new library or a renovated library see between a 30 and a 50% uptick in business. So if you look at the number of visitors, I think it's about 230,000 visitors in 2014. I think, you know, just that alone, that much traffic alone, sort of being there, being available, being prepared for directions and greeting is there's going to be a noticeable uptick.
Especially in the first.
Yeah.
Kevin. Real quick, just in regards to change a little bit of the subject matter, in regards to revenues. So mm-hmm. Bring on a beautiful, brand new library with lots of convention rooms. And also, I think it's a pretty good size hall, correct?
Yes, it's a 150-person community room.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you come up with a game plan for implementation from the standpoint of rentals for those these particular spaces? Who's going to be implementing them and working with the public? And
so,
it's a town.
Well, I think that
it's the rates or the town rates.
Right. The trustees have discussed it.
Yep.
We have a lot of use during the day from tutoring and one-on-one, so that's kind of one thing that we know is going to, we'll see a big increase in that. And in terms of the meeting spaces, we typically charge a nominal fee for meeting
use of meeting room during open hours.
Mm-hmm.
So that is something that has been visited. I'm looking for one of the trustees to help me with. I'm trying to recall what the most recent discussion was, because I know it came up, but
I think we agreed on it, to look at a tiered system that paralleled essentially what the school system does, but that still is within the confines of the trustee policies that have been set, which is not to generate revenue, but to be a
cover the
point
cost
of service.
Yeah.
So kind of following that, as I recall the plans, there's going to be a room that's not open, that is open during during times that the library is not open. Is that, am I correct in remembering that?
That's the meeting room. Yes, that's the plan.
So,
yes.
Because it does seem, I think that's a very fair question that Kevin has raised, and it strikes me that, I'm not sure exactly how that works. Sharon, you might know the answer to this. I mean, can revenue be driven to offset other expenses, or would they be driven towards operating costs? I mean, how would that work from the standpoint of, I'm assuming it's a revolving fund that would...
Yeah, we have one on the school side for rental of school space.
Right.
But I mean, by our very nature, we're meant to be a not-for-profit. We're not meant to be trying to make money off of what we do.
No, but offsetting expenses.
Offsetting expenses, yes. But I think I'd have a hard time understanding what I would put there. You know, we would have to decide, if you have a revolving fund and it's the rental of the library meeting space, what are the expenses that you would use
custodial
to offset?
Whatever.
What particular things would you put there?
Well,
you know, I mean, I know there would be offsetting the expenses, but what expenses? Would it be utility expenses? Like, if, you know, you have to decide what is the purpose of this revolving fund, because all the revolving funds have that purpose, and how do you identify the cost of renting that room?
The reason I ask that question is I know that at the time that the proposition of the retrofit of the building, one of a salient feature was that there was going to be revenue opportunities that were going to be created with the meeting space.
No.
Now, it was clear that, you know, the meeting space was going to be kind of an open to the public thing, and that, oh, by the way, it probably would create revenue. I get that we're not in the for-profit business of renting space. I get that. But
they could offset their budget with a number that they...
This is right where I'm going with it.
Give,
I'm just, you know...
They'd have to be able to support the number that they're coming up with. They'd have to be able to say, well, we figured that our space is rented this amount of time and this percentage of utilities and, you know, custodial fees and things like that. That's what the school does in terms of identifying how much does it really cost us to rent that space. Like, for the schools, it's kind of clear because the school closes at a certain time, and in the afternoon, they're renting to extend a day, for instance.
Right.
Now they need to have custodians there, and their building would have been closed otherwise, or, you know, or maybe minimal people in the
but
building.
They seem
and so
to
they have they certain identifiable costs. So as long as there's a reasonable way of calculating the identifiable cost that you charge back, because you could take this revolving fund revenue and you could offset costs in the library.
Well, there's a variety of ways that you could apportion those costs and allocate those back out from percentages of salaries. I mean, there's a whole series of things, and the school seems to have figured it out.
But are they only renting the space when the library is open or when it's closed?
Both. I'm assuming that
both.
Certain spaces are
both.
Rented during both times. Others, because of the nature of the educational nature of the way the library is being used. I understand that it's all not...
Mm-hmm.
rentable, it's all kind of open to the public, but then there is a pent-up demand
mm-hmm.
for meeting space in town. There's no question about it. I mean, people are leaving town all the time, you know, to have meetings. So I think that there's an opportunity.
It certainly could be set up in that way, there has to be a thought process of what we're supporting the general fund for. Is it part of the utilities,
I think it's part of everything. I think that there is a way to rationalize an apportionment that would really help you, Ruth, get to the place that some of these things that you're looking for, you know, it finds a way to start to rationalize the budget that you're looking, more of the budget that you're looking for,
right.
Because there's offsetting revenues to help so that it doesn't get out, so it doesn't get to these numbers that John talked about, 11% and so forth, and that Dan has brought up. I actually think that there's an internal business method in there
that could be very beneficial to accomplish the things that you're hoping to accomplish.
I agree with you. It's a discussion the superintendent and I have had for a couple of years. If you will, the schools have taken a professional approach to this, and we're still amateurs. We rent out the community room and the police station for $10 or whatever it is.
Yep.
All of us on the town side really need to sit down with the schools and have the same policy. But that's going to also require the same philosophy, which we'll have to have a discussion about. Town rentals or town meeting space is much more for groups that would never pay, boards and committees. Schools are much more designed for groups that would pay. So there's some fundamental disconnect there. And that's the reason why we've never taken, if you will, the professional approach, because as a percent, our uses are going to be much lower. But the library opening with such a beautiful new space is absolutely the opportunity to have that discussion broader. I know there's two school committee members here. We ought to have a broad discussion, and we may or may not come to agreement, but we need to have it.
Yeah, just a question for the library trustees. Would they entertain a review of the policy to, along the lines of what John has described, to at least look at taking the school program and applying it to the best degree possible and inspecting whether there are other differences that might allow you to generate some offset to the costs that are described here in the out years?
Meeting room in particular?
The whole of it. You're going to end up with one of the premier spots in town. That meeting room, as I recollect, is 70 persons, 100 persons, it's fairly large, right?
It's 150, I think.
Yeah, that's going to create a whole new opportunities that are only today met by the school. So I'd try to turn that into as much offset as I could, recognizing that, it's not for, quote, profit, but offsetting expenses isn't profit. That's just kind of staying where you are.
I think it's just a discussion about finding ways to help you. I mean, people aren't really arguing with what you would love to see happen. We're just looking to very difficult ways to get to the funding sources for that. So,
I think certainly we're open to discussion for anything, to look at whatever's going to benefit the library down the road, is offsetting expenses, that kind of thing. But I think we also have to keep in mind, philosophically, we're a public library. We're not out there charging people for services.
Unlike a public school.
Public schools don't charge for the basic services. And part of what we do is have meeting rooms for people. It's part of our services. And I think that we have to keep that in mind also as we're
you might review that, whether meeting rooms is really the best use of the space. I think the primary use of the library is all the things we described above, reference services, periodicals, circulation. There's plenty of places you can get. That might be worth looking at.
That's the spirit of keeping things free. The circulation materials.
Right. That's really the so what.
Well, this is the same discussion school committees had 20 years ago when they started talking about extracurricular fees, quite honestly. It was always free. And all of a sudden, some things weren't.
Good point.
Well, the one question that comes up in regards to that is, if we're charging this at a nominal fee, do we have a policy in place for an organization that's coming in and charging, 150-seat capacity, charging, $40-$50 a seat for a person to come in to put on a performance? Is there a policy that says, we're not going to allow that type of organization coming in and charging?
That's a good point.
We have a very good meeting room policy that we visit that policy often because it is tricky. And,
right.
And we want to make sure that we're really doing the right thing. So we look carefully at who's served. For example, the example that you're using, we have in the past not had commercial events for that very reason. And if something goes on, it has to be open to everyone. It has to be a public event. It has to be free, that sort of thing. So there has been a very consistent application of this very thoughtfully revisited meeting room policy over the years. I mean, it comes up, we look at it probably almost annually and sort of make sure that it suits people. I think the only other thing I'm thinking when we're discussing this is that I think, there's a there's a fair amount of public ownership of this building, as there well should be, and I think, you know, this is entirely funded through state and local funds by the people, and I don't know, some of them, if we had prohibitive rental fees, I think that would be a real problem for some of our local groups.
Just to follow up on that, the reason I bring it up more than anything is that I would assume that there is that kind of demand out there for organizations that would like to rent space that are looking to charge a fee to folks that are coming in. And it may be something that's worth looking at to see from that, again, getting back to offsetting cost standpoint, if there's a way you can look at it from a policy standpoint to determine, you know, if somebody is for profit using the center, then, you know, there's nothing wrong with us being for profit along with them.
Yeah.
And vice versa, if
right.
someone's in there
right.
putting on a community
yeah.
event open to all, free
yeah.
to the public, where you wouldn't have that type of restrictions. I don't know if that's something, Chen, that we could even do or not.
My concern about the offsetting of expenses is a lot of the library expenses are things that I wouldn't say are attributable to renting a meeting space. The librarians, the books, you know. So
No, I agree.
So, you know what I mean? So many things above their budget are not attributable to renting a meeting room.
Right.
More of the utilities, things like
that,
insurance, some of that piece.
The variable costs,
see.
Yeah.
And so you just, the idea of a revolving fund is it's supposed to just run the program that the revolving fund is set up for. So if your revolving fund is rental of space, it should be covering the cost of what does it cost you to rent that space. We're not in business to make a profit, so you shouldn't be charging more than it costs you.
Are we not in business to, or we're not able to?
We're not supposed to.
Okay.
and you have to charge it to the right cost center. Barry?
I mean, I agree that one of the things that a library does, it's basically, it's a forum where you can have a free exchange of ideas. So if that means that there's a meeting room that people can come, I look at that as the same part of the services as when you take out a book or a video or something like that. But that said, we now have 150-seat room that could be used for a lot of things that the library can't or hasn't been able to use now. For example, you know, we could, you know, a speaker series or a music series where, you know, you have to pay a stipend for, you know, a well-known speaker to come, where you would charge a fee. You now have the facility to be able to do that, and I don't think it's outrageous to be able to charge a facility fee for use of something like that, because you're doing a service that we didn't have the capacity for in the old building. So, you know, you're having this space where it's still in the spirit of the library where, you know, doing things and promoting ideas, but now, you know, you think of a major author or, you know, a string quartet or something that maybe that we would never been able to have gotten before, that now we have the space for and people would come to and pay 10 or 20 bucks and the library charges a facility fee. You know, those are the kinds of things that I think that, you know, you might want to think about being open doing. And it also expands the use and then, you know, more people coming to the library for other things than maybe what they've come for.
Mm-hmm. Dan, real quick.
Do you want to respond?
Yeah. Yes, I can see that there's clearly an interest in having us revisit the meeting room policy. The best example that I heard was Cedar Rapids, Iowa, had to rebuild their library after a flood, and they created a lot more public space. And they let it float for 8 to 10 months.
So to speak.
And see how, bad choice, to see how what the demand was. Mm. I mean, obviously the primary focus is that we want to be able to have our story programs in the library. We want to be able to have our foreign affairs discussions in the library. We want to be able to have all of those wonderful services that we can't currently do. And that's, I think, obviously, going to be first priority, but clearly there will be interest broader than library programs, broader than nonprofits, maybe broader than traditional town programs. So I would just suggest that this discussion would be really useful in about 10 months when we've moved in, sort of see how these rooms are kitted up, see what kinds of requests we're getting for the use of that space, and then start talking about how that works.
Yeah.
On the back, and then John.
Yeah, just had a quick question. Do you know how the Boston Public Library or some of the libraries out in the western part of the state then manage renting their libraries for weddings?
Right. Some libraries do, yeah.
Because I do know there are a couple in the Western part of the state, the Boston Public Library.
Yep.
So with these concerns, do you know how they actually deal with that in terms of the revolving fund that the accountant brought up and your concerns? How do they manage that?
I don't know how they reconcile that with town government. I mean, I do know that this is something that happens, and I you know that people work it out. I have heard from I've heard various stories about it. So, but how that works with how that squares with town accounting, I don't know.
I would have to think it maybe it's a de minimis amount that they're actually
You found it.
Sounds like somebody got married in the library.
John.
But I
can't
imagine that they do a lot of weddings.
They do.
At what point did you lose control over the budget discussion?
I'll go to the side.
We need.
All right.
You're losing control of your meeting.
John.
Ruth and members of the trustees, I think you are hearing a strong and somewhat consistent view that this lovely edifice that we're constructing has so much more potential that we haven't mined. And I would ask you to separate what is might be a personal preference from what should be good policy and, frankly, is good stewards of what the public invested in. I understand if the library is open, the entity ought to be open to the public. But if somebody wants to come in as somebody who helped fund that, I'd expect that the stewards of that building find a way to take advantage of that situation and at least offset their costs. That's just being good stewards of the investment we've just made. There's plenty of ways to get it done. There's a lot of smart people in the room on the matters of finance and what the schools have done and what can be done legally. And I'd urge you to revisit the topic. I do think 10 months from now is far too late. You know this library is opening. You know the calendar date for it. We've known, broadly speaking, the schedule for the building opening. And it doesn't need to be a perfect plan, but I would urge you not to wait until the enterprise is up and running to decide, well, let's solve this problem, because it can be solved now. It at least can be started now. Thank you.
Any final comments, Ruth, or any of the trustees? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
I'm going to call a 5-minute recess.
Thank you.
It's a way to clear your throat before you start talking. It's an affectation.
Mr. Zager, would you want to go over the public works budget for us?
Me and Mike Zager, I always know the last one in my mind, so this is
okay.
Appreciate it.
I think we're on page 100.
100.
So I'd just like to, before we start, introduce my assistant director, Jake Gonzalez here, and he's in public works for a number of years as a business manager, then disappeared and stole her for a year and a half or so, and not just back as assistant director.
She disappeared.
I really want to say that obviously she's doing a great job. You know, since September she came as the assistant director, but also she's also doing things for other departments and interim hiring.
She's doing at least five jobs.
She's doing a lot. So I just to recognize that, I think was appropriate. What I'd like to do is just kind of go over some of the highlights between FY 16 and 17 and kind of focus on those. The overall budget is a modest increase. It's up 1.7%. Structurally, I think everybody's aware of the department with the various divisions. We have the highway and equipment maintenance, the parks, forestry, cemetery, water and sewer, engineering and administration. Currently, we have five long-term seasonal employees, mostly in the parks, forestry, cemetery. We have four short-term seasonals, a couple of them in the water, a couple of them in the highway. We have 55 full-time employees for FY 17. That's down one employee, one engineering position. It's not in the general fund, it's in the enterprise fund, but that's one of the positions that we're looking at next year. The wages in general in engineering, one of the interim position is being eliminated. When I first came, that position was not part of the budget. It was not there. It was added, I think, 2 years ago. We've had it for a couple of years now, I believe. And next year, going forward, it's being eliminated. That will leave us with five full-time engineering staff, which, and we have, as you know, we have two PEs currently on staff, town engineer, and one of the senior civil engineers, also PE. Also, I think the board is aware is that the current town engineer is retiring in June. I'd like to start that process sooner rather than later. Hopefully, my goal is to get somebody on board 1st of April, middle of April. I'm looking for a lag, you know, with a position at least 6 weeks or so in filling that full-time position. Again, also in engineering, we added $4,000 in the overtime line item. I think as kind of a little bit of a base to go going forward in terms of maybe covering some of the duties that we may be losing in maybe the interim position of one of the engineers to fill in on some of the inspections, especially during some of the time where, for example, on Fridays, where currently we have 4 days.
Yep.
I mean, people are still doing work, construction people are still doing water work. We've got paving going on, so that overtime helps fill in some of those gaps, especially on Fridays and off hours. As we mentioned before, the town engineer position is going to 40 hours. It's currently at 37 and a half. That's the 40 hours will start July 1st. Similarly, continuing with wages and administration, the director's position is again going to 40 hours versus 37 and a half, which has been the case for some time. All divisions in terms of wages do reflect all the collective bargaining agreements that are in place with the three unions now. We have AFSCME and the engineering union and also the supervisors union. Plus the wages does reflect the non-union cost of living and step increases that are a part of the package. Expense-wise, again, look at engineering, there was a small increase in the professional development. Again, looking at a new kind of staffing structure there, I thought it was important to put some additional funding in there for training and for other professional development with the engineering division. Also a small increase in the traffic control signal repair line item. We're in a position now, we're gonna start looking at doing some preventive maintenance on some of these signals that have been around for a while, and I think this is a good place to start to put some funding in that particular line item. Under the highway, there's a small increase in the equipment vehicle maintenance repairs, just reflecting some cost increases in parts and equipment associated with the repairs of the vehicles and the equipment. Again, that's a modest increase there. Those are kind of the major areas in terms of wages and expenses that are going up. Some of the big picture items that also are changing slightly, actually the snow and ice account is level funded going forward for next year. That's not changing. Mm-hmm. The street lighting is a slight decrease based on current projections in the street lighting account, and there's also a slight decrease in our trash recycling account. Currently, we have a proposal out, contract proposal. Currently, it's with town council. He's reviewing it right now. I'm hoping to get that out within the next couple of weeks. We are gonna go out and get some pricing, solicit probably four or five bids or our proposals from companies. I think the board is aware we did get a proposal from a current vendor, JRM, a number of months ago. They proposed a 10-year yep. extension. And frankly, I think that's too long. I think that's a long period of time with technology changing and things happening. Mm-hmm. I've talked with Bob a little bit about what would be more appropriate. I think a 5-year type of agreement would make more sense, because you know town meeting did vote us the authorization to go beyond the 3 years, so we could do that. So I'm hoping to get proposals in hand sometime at the end of February, and then we'll take a look at them. Did some tweaking in the current program. Frankly, the last contract we did a lot of tweaking. I mean, that's where we added a lot of different components to the trash contract. We added the leaf collection, we added the mandatory recycling. A lot of those pieces were added at that point.
Bulk item.
Yeah. Right, yeah. Right. So that was, so this one, we did, like I say, tweak a few things. But going forward, right now, it's a fairly competitive market, so hopefully we'll get some good pricing. I'm pretty confident we will.
Real quick in regards to that. Has there been any discussion with them in regards to doing automated recycling? You know, they have the manual, the barrels that they put out now, that
like Wakefield.
The big manual arm grabs it and kind of dumps it all. It's an all-in-one, put all your recycles in the same package.
Currently, under the current contract, we could actually go to single-source recycling right now. I mean, to combine the recycling component as opposed to now separating them,
right.
You know, separating them out. We could do that
for us.
We've looked at that. I know James looked at a lot of different communities in that, and really, there wasn't a lot of benefit to doing that at this point. And as far as the automated is concerned, there's some pretty high price pieces of that. I mean, you've got to buy all the containers. I think we looked at that 5 years ago, and we were in the $750,000 range just to buy all the containers.
Right, that one year.
Right, for that 1 year.
Then
you go from there, and then because once you do that, then you're in for the long haul. You're not gonna spend that kind of money and then change back again.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
My feeling is, you know what, in 2012, we were an award-winning community for recycling. I mean, I have my plaque downstairs on my desk that I show people when they come in. But I mean, and that really.
Me too.
And we still get a lot of positive feedback from the public, you know, just that they love the program.
Oh, it's a great program.
And I was
wondering if there's any kind of more benefit further, because I know we've gotten to the point where we're maximizing our benefit, which has been great.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I don't particularly think there is,
okay.
To be honest with you. Anyway.
Similar question, Jeff. I mean, every time I go down to the DPW and drop off another electronic appliance that's met end of life, I ask myself, there must be a healthy revenue stream that comes out of precious metals and whatever else they're turning these things into. Do you have a sense that we're getting our fair shake on that kind of stuff?
We're paying, what is it, so much a load to have that removed. Copper's down 25%.
Yeah, all commodities are down, I know, but prior to, say, September.
We're paying minimal, but this contract that we're looking to put out, we'll have it included.
but the new contract will include that, because right now it's, we have a vendor that, you know, is trying to get him to do a pickup, you know, it's delayed, and, you know, it's just, with the new contract, that's going to be part of the contract, that whenever we call, it's going to be picked up and recycled, so going forward. The other thing, quickly, if I could, if I think you did get the handout, I think some of the Department of Public Works, some of the, what I try to put together is there are a few highlights that things that have happened in the past and kind of going forward within the department. In the past 2 years, there have been 5 retirements, 8 promotions, and 7 new hires. So there's been a lot of changes. We've got 3 new supervisors currently in place. Again, this is within the last couple of years. Then going forward, there'll be 2 more. Obviously, the engineer, Donna, she'll be one. And also, there's another pending retirement within a year or so down the road with my Parks Forestry Cemetery. So with that period of time, there'll be a lot of changes. But I think so far, we've had some so we have a very strong professional development program, a lot of training. I know, talking with Bob, we've bumped the line items up in a couple of different budgets in terms of professional development training. And a lot of the employees have taken advantage of it. They've got their licenses. They've gone to certain training. I have 2 of my supervisors today go to a drug and alcohol screening type seminar that was held. So we take advantage of a lot of that. A lot of that is offered through Maya. A lot of it is free. And through some of the training and some of the things we do go to, we do get a benefit through the Maya program as a reduction in our insurance premiums. In fact, I think we're up to like $45,000 or $50,000 reduction because we take full advantage of that as a item that we could, you know, funding, reduce our premium for our general liability insurance. Also, another bullet, since 2011, 107 roads, or sections of roads, have been resurfaced, coming to about 22.5 miles with a total cost of $6.1 million. We've done a lot in the last, since 2011. I think we're at a point now where we're due for a field check. As you know, we have a pavement management program, and we use that as part of our program going forward to put together our road program. To me, it shouldn't be the total guide. I mean, we use it as a guide, but it shouldn't be the only factor going forward. I mean, there are other factors certainly in our paving program that we use. For example, if we have a capital project, either a water project or a sewer project, well, sure. For example, like a minor street, that's part of the paving program because obviously it makes sense to do it. So I think, but it's been, I believe, 4 or 5 years since we've had actually field study where somebody will go out. The current program was through VHB, the engineering firm that put together the current pavement maintenance program, and we're due to have a field check, and actually they'll go around and look at all the streets and do an analysis of a grading system, like 1 through 5, 5 being a brand new street, 1 being one that's totally falling apart. And I think it'll be interesting. I can guarantee that our pavement condition index has gone up. I think originally it was in the 72% range. Those things don't go up as dramatically as you might think, but I know that it's going to be at least in the mid-70s, high 70s, which is pretty good in terms of the overall pavement condition for the town.
Jeff, is there any way to portray that to the public?
Oh, sure. Yeah, we can put together. Once we do that, we can run an analysis, and then we can see where we've come from, where we are now, and
trending again,
and where we were at.
On any particular road, it might be useful to have a something, a quick lookup that says I'm on Irving Street.
Yep.
That creates more negative publicity than positive.
I know it says Dick Safe Marks on some of the very newest paved roads. Why are those?
It could be a utility. It could be like a Boston Gas. It could be, that's usually what happens a lot of.
Especially they're not allowed to dig those up, right?
Well, once the street is paved, we have an internal rule that, basically we send all the utilities our pavement list. Yeah. And with the pavement list is a letter that, listen, for the next 3 years, don't come looking for a street opening permit because these are newly paved roads. Because what happens if there's an emergency leak or break or something happens?
But that's different.
But in general, they're very aware of what our paving program looks like and going forward. So hopefully that alleviates some of that problem.
Yeah, Bob.
There's some home rule petitions that have actually been approved that both address the street opening situation and double poles, where communities are being given a little more power by this administration to take care of their own business. So that if you have double poles, you can really whack the utilities or whoever is responsible, hopefully not RMLD, for a good amount. And the same with the utility company not cooperating before you pave, and then they suddenly go in and offer gas. You can make them repave the whole road, not just patch it.
Right.
So, you know, that's something we may want to pick up maybe next summer.
Sure.
Maybe have our legislators in and see how that's gone. But a couple communities have done that, you know, with no results yet.
The other thing I do want to mention, I just got a report. We talked a little about the recycling piece. December, our recycling percentage was 34.96%, almost 35% recycling. That's the highest. We've been running around 30%, and that's like the highest. I could be wrong, but I believe it's either the highest or one of the highest in the state for communities that don't have a pay-as-you-throw program, which obviously that's even more incentive to go that recycling route. But in general, it's really, really a product. I mean, that's a great rate, 35%.
35%
of the trash holds right.
Participating, or
35% of the overall trash is recycled.
By ton, right. By weight.
Yeah, right. It's all by weight. One of the other handouts we talked about, I have the sheet with the board, is just going forward, the C-Flix Fix program has been ongoing since its inception. Just to give you a little bit of an idea, some of the specifics, we've had 557 issues that have come up, and potholes, we had 92 issues fixed. These are all fixed, so these are all fixed. We had sidewalk, 57 issues fixed, tree branches, 37, street, 31, street lights, 31, snow and ice, 28, signs, 24, drainage, stormwater, 12, rubbish recycling, 13, traffic signals, 10, manhole catch basin, 11, tree removal, 4. So there was, it's an assortment of different categories, but we get them, and the system that's set up now really works pretty well. I know going forward, I know the town is looking at maybe expanding that whole C-Click Fix into the other departments in terms of the town. Right now, it's Public Works, and I believe the town manager's.
And Matt.
And Matt will be the one looking at that going forward.
Yeah, I'm using it now. It's great.
Yep. Yep. Jeff, have you seen an increase in the number of C-Click Fix requests over the last few months? I know, you know, we advertising it a little bit, its availability. I know we talked a little bit at a town meeting, but, you know, is there a strategy to kind of let everybody know that they can just download it really easily? And because the cost fit is fixed. We paid for it. So
right.
It doesn't cost anything more
right.
for people to use it.
Initially, we did do a lot of public outreach in terms of making, you know, looking at, it's always on the website. It's in our DPW report and various things to try to promote it, but something we could even do even more probably.
How do we follow those now, Jeff? So when somebody, you know, sends a photograph in, how do we respond to them? Because in the very beginning,
right, there was some issues, right?
You know,
it'll come in depending on what the category is. Say if it's a pothole, first of all, I get copies of everything because I want to see what's coming in and what's not coming in. Then it gets referred to the appropriate department. So a pothole will be highway, and the person who sends it will get an acknowledgement that it's been received. And then once it gets to the appropriate party, once that issue is taken care of, now, you know, a pothole can be a little bit tricky in that, you know, it may come in, well, you have to send out a crew for one pothole. So
yeah.
It may be a few days where you've got, you go up and get, you know, 2 tons of mix, you come in and do a number of them. But once it's repaired, it's closed out again, and so it'll be closed out, and the person who sent it in will get a notification.
Don't we have online access to some
you do.
Of the stats?
Yes.
I think I've done that, Johnny. You can start an account, and you can watch everything happening in writing.
Yeah, it's all real-time data. You can actually watch.
Yeah.
You can look at an individual response and track, and it doesn't have to be yours.
So that's a big improvement over when we started with this.
Absolutely.
That was the gaping hole in the very beginning.
There was no fault.
So
it wasn't that it wasn't getting done. It was that the person that, you know, filed it wasn't sure what was going to be next. So I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah.
I've used it a couple of times, and I do get those automated emails that it's been assigned to a particular person.
Right.
It's a good, and then when it's taken
system.
Did you get them to cut your grass?
Oh! Yeah, that's in here. That's
one
of the cats.
That's
one of the
ones.
How do you do that, Joe?
That's in other. That's in other.
Oh, I see.
Just in general, a couple of other quick items on that, you know, the DPW divisions, now we have quick online access to 17,000 water and sewer cards. We've done a lot of scanning, and a lot of the information is available out in the field, as well as the engineering plans are being scanned for access out in the field as well. So we made some good good progress in that area. And capital program, I just want to mention going forward next year. Obviously, we still have a lot of things going on. I mean, some of the things that projects that are not town projects, obviously West Street's going to continue. We're projecting now to have that. Hopefully, everything goes according to plan sometime, probably in the summer, maybe July. We've been lucky. They've been working right through, you know, with the weather. It's worked out. They've been doing a lot of the conduit now is in for the signals. A lot of the curbing is in. We've been making progress, but that'll continue on. Oak Street, which is the MWRA project, that's going to be starting up in the spring. There's a pre-construction meeting there. They're going to start that sewer water project. And then we've got our projects, Salem Street, that water project. It's been approved by the town meeting. It's a capital project. Yep. That's going to be starting up in the spring. The sewer stations, those are out to bid now. Those are going to start up again in the spring. Our roadway paving program for next year, we've got 20 roads lined up to start that. So, and plus we got our own drainage projects. There's a lot. There's a lot going on, and it's going to be a busy year. Like I said, I look forward to it.
Very good. Questions? Barry?
I know earlier this year we talked about we had gone out to bid on some projects and they just came back so out of whack. Are you seeing any changes in that or improvements?
You know, I think part of that, some of those things come in from the outside. I mean, they're outside consultants that provide some of that information now. Obviously, you know, we've got a part of that where we review those. But you know what? I've noticed, I mean, I've been around for a few years and I just noticed in the last 2 or 3 years, and not just here, a lot of the estimates are coming in from various communities. And I talked to my colleagues in other communities. You know, some places are worse than others, but I don't know whether it's the quality of the engineers. Oh, for whatever reason, it seems like it's been more of an issue the last 2 or 3 years. And I don't really know why other than that being the reason. But, you know,
Is it a case of scale where you're asking for a bid for a sewer pumping station where, you know, it's one item, they don't do that much work, maybe they don't want to do the job, so they jack the price up?
Possibly, yeah, I mean, possibly. Yeah.
I get the sense there's not a lot of competition in the marketplace.
We cornered the market in that particular commodity.
Jeff, are you seeing any volatility in the roadbed materials, what with petroleum prices or?
Actually, yeah, with as far as going forward with that, we have a bid in place right now for asphalt, but I know going forward, I know a couple of communities have gone out to bid and there's been some reductions in their paving. We have another year to go, I think, on the current paving?
July,
okay. So going forward, I would suspect everything else staying the same, there will be some reductions in our asphalt parade. And as far as, obviously, with our fuel costs, those have gone down dramatically in the budget.
The fuel costs, I get. I'm wondering, do our contracts generally have a circuit
escalation,
breaker?
Yeah.
If it goes above or below, it's a renegotiation?
Yep.
Have we triggered that yet on the downside?
I think it's only above.
It's only above, yeah.
Nobody ever thought about it before.
No.
No one ever envisioned
it.
Oh,
yeah, it's a gallon, folks, in Michigan.
Yeah. You can't drink the water.
Yeah. Beware. You don't want to kill, you don't want to kill the shale industry. Then it's going up to four again.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Jeff.
Thanks.
Yeah. All right, enterprise funds, you going to cover that, Bob?
I will.
Okay.
Yeah, may as well. First, I want to talk about a change in some accounting for the enterprise funds since Sharon's here. And Sharon did this. Behind me is FY 16 and 17, and I want to especially direct you to water and sewer. Individually, there's been a significant change in how this affects each fund, but collectively, you can see it's not really a big change combined. I'll give you just a real brief history. The prior town accountant and I worked on this for quite some time. We inherited a system that was 10 years old. It was done in precise studies for a short period of time spent by different people, such as the town manager on each of these, but not updated, so it just for 10 years sort of progressed. The prior town accountant and I did a lot of surveys, discussed with the state, and it turns out there was no best practice, and there still is no best practice on this. There are some better practices, I guess I'd say. And we became a little concerned that if we had an audit, this is one of the areas an audit firm can look at, and we had to have something that was really easy to understand, easy to defend, and very transparent. And ours met most of those tests, but one of the things that we didn't feel it was really very good was we had one full-time engineer in the stormwater fund. That's something that was done a few years ago in preparation for a lot of federal mandates, which have come down in some measure. But that actual person was not spending 100% of his time on stormwater, and many other engineers were spending some time on stormwater. So that got us to thinking of just redoing a new method and saying, let's back off, let's make it real simple, let's do it on an FTE basis. The prior method did it on a budget basis. So for instance, sewer is 3/4 MWRA expense.
Mm-hmm.
Do we really spend the town manager's time on that portion of the budget,
no,
or is it really based on the stuff that's local? And our argument was it's the stuff that's local. So that if you do it on an FTE basis, sewer is much smaller. And you can see there's a $70,000 reduction in the overhead. But water is higher because the MWRA charge to water is about 25% of the budget. So the long and short of it is, this is, it's not a huge change, but it's just an important change to keep in the back of your mind. And, you know, there's a lot of specific accounting. The one change really is in the effect on the stormwater fund. It's an increase of $30,000. And we felt that was very justified because within the next month or two, there is expected to be in effect for July 1st some pretty serious federal stormwater regulations, so that we will have a number of employees working on stormwater issues. And stormwater is something I'll want to discuss with you in a minute.
Is that tied up in that EPA jurisdiction over local waters? I thought that was in court.
It may be in court.
Or maybe got overturned.
It's also being handed down as a mandate.
I've been waiting for four years.
Yeah, it's been a while. I previewed this
last week.
Water and sewer combined are forecast to be about up 5% in rates and budget. And to one of your earlier questions on the sewer system replacements, in order to keep this increase at 5 instead of closer to 10%, we had to push out $3 million worth of sewer rehab work out a year. So that was not expected a year ago. With the MWRA current forecasts on water and sewer, we just couldn't hit a reasonable number, I thought. So we pushed it out. And that was after a lot of internal discussion that it was certainly fine to do that.
A question on the MWRA sewer assessments. I thought that was primarily the, you know, the interest in principal on Deer Island. That seems to be going up over time. Why is that going up over time?
It's their debt. It's the way they've refinanced and financed their debt. They have a huge structure of debt out there for sewer.
Not just Deer Island.
No,
well, what they did.
No, it's the whole infrastructure.
Oh, that's true.
The
yeah,
same,
all that.
Same size as Deer Island.
Like 68% of that budget, I think, is debt.
Well, that's water.
It's, yeah, it's unbelievable.
That's not sewer.
Portion.
Oh, that's right.
So next year, you know, the water sewer rates will be approximately 5% of the $40 per household
stuff.
Charge can hold.
Hey, Bob, was there any feedback on when we got the water and sewer bills went out like recently?
There was a long line the last day, just like there used to be.
Right.
So for those at home, we used to have a 10% discount for early payment, and the last day there were fist fights in the parking lot to get that 10%. Well, the same fist fights happened this year, and it was just over not paying interest the next day. So.
So
I guess it's human nature.
People paying the bills.
Yeah.
I haven't got a report as to whether they paid faster or slower yet. My observation was the collectors didn't notice a big difference.
But it's only 1 year, and it takes a while to learn.
Yeah.
What's the vox pop on that? Do they like it?
I've gotten no complaints. So have you got any, Matt? Any comments on water, sewer?
Not recently.
That's probably a good sign,
yeah,
because usually we...
You probably
got
enjoy being treated like adults.
Probably, exactly.
What a concept.
See, your local government does that.
Yeah, in water and sewer, I think next year is going to be reasonable, but the board and the public needs to be aware that we do have some serious infrastructure needs. We are much better at addressing them than most communities, and they're going to cost money over the next several years. So there'll be a real philosophical discussion at the selectmen's level as to can we continue to be aggressive and take care of our infrastructure, or do we need to slow down? It's going to cost.
Yeah.
And there'll also be a philosophical discussion on what is the Stormwater Enterprise Fund meant to be, because there is virtually no way to do the work that has been requested. And you can see some listed below, some projects that are $1.7 million that are new stormwater projects. There's no way to hold the $40 household fee if this is how we do them. So that's going to be a philosophical discussion.
Those big
projects, the 1.2 million, the 610, do we, those are scheduled, do we do any assessments, or is there a vehicle to do an assessment to establish whether there's any residual life and you can take it off?
Well, for the sewer station repairs, there's a half or a dozen or so of those scheduled over some period of time. These are the most urgent ones, regardless of size.
I realize you can't inspect everything, but something like a water tank, can you spend a few bucks on an inspection and say, you know what, we don't need to spend $1.2 million this year.
We did that a few years ago with the current water tank that still doesn't have a new paint job on it for a whole variety of reasons. But yeah, you can do that. Virtually any piece of infrastructure you have in water sewer can wait another year unless it's broken, and knock on wood, it's not broken.
And you don't want to wait till it's broken.
Well, you don't want to wait till it's broken, but there's no way to absolutely know that.
The only reason I bring it up, some of these are big enough where moving it a year or two might actually help. The nickels and dimes, it doesn't help. But a $3 million project or a $1 million project, you just spend $25K to push it out 3 or 4 years.
Yeah. We have done that, I would say, more in water. Yeah. I'm more familiar with that, doing that exact thing in water, where we spend some money and say, let's move it out 2 years.
Because we've done so much in water to this point, you're in a position you can do that.
Thank you.
Yeah. That's really all I have in the enterprise funds. We'll schedule the board to have a rate hearing, I don't know, probably in April before town meeting, but after the election. And we'll have more discussion at that point.
Okay. So on the benefits.
Shared costs. I'll start with a couple of points on benefits. Health insurance is clearly the biggest factor. We have an 8% premium assumption that's a little higher in the budget for some other small reasons. I wanted to bring this, though, up to your attention, because this has been discussed in public in the past, that the school department's rate of health insurance increases were higher for a 4-year period, and they were. But for the current year to date, that's actually reversed slightly for what that's worth. It's a small data point, but just so you know. So they were running, and this is an all-in cost. This is the cost of premiums plus enrollment. So the schools were running at a 4.5% pace, the town at a 1% pace. And you know, now it's reversed slightly. And again, we've had a lot of discussion about health insurance. It's a difficult topic. Our rate of actual premium increase is one of the best in the area, period. The PEC has been really good to work with and negotiate with. We've kept costs down. I'm hearing unofficially there is some GIC news out that will make us very glad we didn't join the GIC. And we'll just leave it at that. We do have another opportunity, though, to address the GIC next fall. If they, square up their ship a little bit more, it may be an attractive thing. It's always an option. But for so far, it's been a good option to miss. In debt and capital, the red line is scheduled capital, but more importantly, the blue line is committed debt, and that's what you'd expect to see for debt. Our reliance on debt is far less than it was 10 years ago, which is a good thing. It gives you a lot more flexibility. And our debt service, it only goes out 10 years, which for most communities, that's an unusual thing. Most communities are out 20 years. We've done a really good job of not mortgaging the future, I guess is my point on this.
Is that going down, Bob, because you haven't scheduled 10 years out fully, or is it going down because you don't expect to?
It's going out because we don't necessarily know what debt finance projects are out there that we haven't figured out,
right, okay.
Such as the DPW garage.
Yeah.
That's nowhere. Mm-hmm. There's a cemetery garage in there, but there's not a DPW
right.
garage.
Thank you.
When does the high school debt get retired relative to the
It's 20
the
year.
20
right here. 24 for the high school, 26 for the library. And most of the library's in 25. It's the tail piece in 26. So that's what I thought was an interesting fact, that basically one-third of our debt service is paid for inside the levy and two-thirds are excluded. And that's a good thing, generally. And one could argue in the past that some portion of this for a lot of the school work should have been done outside the levy, and it really squeezed our operating budget. Barrows and Wood End, for instance, were done inside the levy. The other items are very small and very nominal. Vocational education we really only guess at, and state assessments we guess at. But again, those numbers are so small that it's not going to much matter.
What about the reimbursement for last year's snow and ice from the state?
The fire chief tells me it's still slow. We've been through
we talked about it earlier.
Yeah, three different federal employees that keep retiring or changing, and that's one way never to pay is just keep changing your liaison.
Every time they change the liaison, they change the phone. So it's
yeah.
like it's.
But
they
it's,
haven't.
It's
I mean, the FEMA hasn't settled that across the board, has it?
No.
No.
I mean, it's still hanging.
Yeah.
I mean, it's in a relative way. There's some tacit agreement to some numbers, but
someday.
there's no cash on the barrel.
Right now, they're actively reviewing our project, and they go through it line by line. They're looking at payroll receipts, making sure our vendors were paid. And that's the stage they're at now. So
I'm familiar with that process, and I know that they're turning it inside out, almost to the point that it appears to almost be a stalling technique.
Delay.
Whether or not there's not the money, and I mean, are they waiting for another budget year? Is that what's going on?
They each year that they do this, it becomes more and more strict. And I'll give you an example. For police and fire, for emergency services, if we put extra staff on for a storm, we would get reimbursed for that extra staff that we needed because the slower response, it's just harder to do our jobs. And they changed that to the point where now they'll pay you for that, but only when they're on a call. So you have to go through your runs and say, okay, they were on a call from this time to that time, mm-hmm. and bill for that time only.
So they don't pay for the shift, they pay for the grind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they'll pay for the salary for the time that they're on call, and then the value of the vehicle that they were in, the equipment that they used. So it's very time consuming to do.
Yeah.
To do.
But it's 100.
And that's why we don't budget this stuff. You never know when it's coming.
You never know when it's going to show up.
The bottom line of this portion of the budget is it's well behaved. You know, a 2.5% increase isn't so bad. But that's slightly influenced by the fact we did a slug of capital at November town meeting, current year, which brings up, you know, the FY16 number. But it's still not too bad. As a summary, I just want to wrap it up real quickly because I know it's late. We have a town operating an accommodated budget of 2.5%. You know, you've heard all the reasons for that. In terms of what you've discussed going forward, and some of this has changed based on the library's plans, but I'll come up with a more comprehensive list. But these are some of the things that were in the level services budget that could be afforded within the resources available. So we already discussed the inspections revolving fund last week. I had a slight hint from some members of the board you might be interested in that. There is a $200,000 annual spending limit on that set by town meeting. There is a $75,000 allocation in the current budget, so there's $125,000, if you will, available to be used. There's a $707,000 balance, so if you use $200,000, you can basically do it for 4 years. Mm. I don't think you'll need to spend quite that much, no matter what you do. In the general fund, there's a little less than $30,000 unallocated, primarily because the schools saved some money a couple weeks ago. I put down what I thought would be my choices based on what I knew. A couple thousand for the library budget, just because we did increase the operating budgets and they did not get any share of that. I thought of all the positions that were affordable, the vacant crossing guard position is one. We know that if we're going to need it, we're going to fill it. So, you know, that's one possibility, and I'd throw the rest in pay in class, honestly. But I'll come up with a more comprehensive list, and I know the library's priority is not Sunday hours. It's that substitute thing for $6,000, right. So that might be a reasonable thing to ask for. There wasn't as much money this year to leave to you at the end, just because it would have required another reduction somewhere.
That inspections revolving fund. Mm. Tell me how that can be spent.
Any lawful purpose that is voted by town meeting, so there is no limit. But town meeting has to approve.
And so.
So last year, for instance, we balanced a snow and ice deficit by using some of it.
Really?
Yeah.
But it's one. You don't want to use it for one time.
That's the philosophical desire. Yeah. Right.
So the $125,000 maximum. Is there because I thought it was a $200,000 annual.
There is, and I've already baked in $75,000 of offsets into Gene's budget. extra inspection hours, a document storage project,
okay,
and some overtime for night meetings.
All right, so, and that's, that actually makes sense, because it's being spent.
Back
where it came from.
So if you only used my approach, you'd have another 10 years, $75,000 a year for 10
but
years.
But that fund replenishes itself.
Not so much.
No, usually,
it's only the three
only
largest
the
projects.
Yeah.
The big projects really drove.
Now, if a fourth large project comes along, we could have a discussion and say, you know, we ought to put the permits in that. You know, we develop Walker's Brook.
That 40B project that we talked about earlier, would that impinge on some of the funds or add to
it? I don't know. That's a good question.
What's the dollar per square foot on the fee?
We've generally discussed projects that were larger than that in the past. Mm. But, you know, that's a fair point.
We need to get every penny of that value.
Yeah.
Yeah, and just to be clear,
yes,
you know, you don't pay any more or less. It's just where that goes, where's the permit funds go. And for the three largest historic projects, it went into this fund. And one of the reasons it went into it, quite honestly, was a discussion on Walker's Brook, the landfill, the first time around, where we should have done this and didn't and learned from our mistake. We had costs that came along related to that project, such as police officers.
Right.
You suddenly have a retail trade, you needed to hire more police officers. There were almost no school costs that came along with that project, but we continued to allocate a two-thirds, one-third as revenue. And we realized that was a mistake. We should have figured out what are the costs off the top, and
mm-hmm.
whatever's left over, you split it two-thirds, one-third.
So is it safe to say that if you wanted to hire a resource officer, that's a place you could do that?
You could. It's a little awkward, but you could. There's no lawful reason you couldn't do that.
That whole bothers me, to be honest with you. I mean, we've heard about a lot of things, and I know that there's been, you know, a lot of things that needed to be reduced or removed. And I understand that in the interest of, you know, being fiscally prudent. It just, that's one that, you know, is hard for me to leave out.
Yeah, and I'm not speaking to the importance, but in my way of looking at it, it's not even a level service. It's something nice to have. It's something we don't currently have. And look at all the other things that we had to cut, and look at all the things that were considered level service. And in terms of purely looking at what's being delivered now, it's a lower priority. Doesn't mean it's not important and couldn't be considered on a merit basis. It would be more important than some of the things we're doing. But it's philosophically difficult for me to add something when I'm taking away.
I understand.
Yeah.
I understand how it got there.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of speaking out loud about
mm-hmm.
the concept of it. I mean, you know, how many Narcans? 17? Yeah. I mean, we've got to do things that give us a fighting chance here. And, you know, it strikes me that what we've seen with the resource officer in the high school is that I think good things have happened there as a result of, you know, people we've had. And
yeah, no doubt.
You know, but we all know, I mean, we know from the studies that we've looked at. I think we know if we sit and actually have a conversation, you know, with the chief and with his resource officer that there's a hole there, you know, at the younger ages. I just think moralistic, I understand exactly where you're coming from. I'm just speaking out loud moralistically about this.
And the only thing I'd caution you on is to have a discussion with the school department to try to understand what they're doing and make sure that whatever we want to do fits in with that.
Right.
Because I'm not that up to speed on what they're doing at the middle school level, for instance. I know they're putting a lot of resources in the same area, just because it's not called school resource over behavioral health.
Well, they cut that out last year.
Well,
I
don't want to speak for them.
This is
year.
Another thing that...
I think that's an important part of the puzzle, though, is what are the schools doing?
Or not.
Or not.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
And then, I said this last week, it's the same thing. FY18 is going to be a budget reduction. You're not going to be talking about adding anything, I don't think. If we're looking at the same kind of historic revenue growth and we, you know, are hit with 8% health insurance costs and so forth, you're going to be talking about what services do we not do anymore.
Right.
It's as simple as that. And again, to be more clear, there are some positions, especially at Town Hall, where there's a unique person that does a unique thing. Mm-hmm. To eliminate that service. There's other departments that have depth in staff and do a variety of things, and you know, they may have to be addressed also. So it's not a pleasant discussion, but it's one that's fair. It's something that's out there. So that's all I have.
Very good. Yes, John.
Just to amplify Bob's points, reading ahead, it's clear that there'll be all manner of analyses that show and justify 2018 spend. And I have no idea which way the wind is blowing in the voter environment. And all the energy we put into describing the future needs to cover both the both prospects, whether an override if it's contemplated passes, and if an override if it's contemplated fails. We need to have equally well documented and instrumented processes. And what I see frequently, and it's human nature, is we describe we're going to. I'm talking about the town side when I'm not trying to preach, but I see too often that here's all the things we're going to do, and if we don't do those, the sky will fall. And
right.
We can't do that. The sky won't fall. We'll find a way to get it done, but some things aren't going to get done any longer. And that's the, we need a real sober approach in how we describe to the public what isn't going to get done. That's kind of clear and concise and doesn't have any, doesn't pull any punches. So I want to see that energy that's put into the positive also put into the negative. So if that outcome should pass,
I think it's got to be just totally transparent and educational. I agree with you, John.
As I mentioned, I think before, the FinCom state manual, FinComs can present two budgets, and one with an override, one without. They can develop two budgets.
Yeah, I mean, I think we are going to be talking about asking the voters to pay more.
They may say no.
If they say no, well, we spend what we have. But if we're going to ask them, well, we have to give the leadership of what is it that we're going to be asking. You know, adding a school resource officer to one that we already have, we have to justify why that's needed. So it just can't be, well, we need to have you pay more to keep the same services. We're going to have to be adding services if it makes sense to ask people to pay more. You just can't have it be, well, it's just to cover what we already do. That's DOA. We have to say, if we're going to be asking for more, this is what additionally we're going to get. In addition to, obviously, if we don't get more, this is what we're going to do. But potentially we can't do anymore. So.
Real quick, Rob, is there a vehicle that you know of that we could present more than two potential budgets? You know, a plus, making this up, a plus X, a plus Y, and a plus Z. Because in the end, if somebody may want, you know, not the mama bear, the papa bear, or something in the middle, right?
I don't see any legal reason you couldn't do it. I see a sort of a staff resource limitation of some sort.
Well, I don't mean with that perfect granularity, but to Barry's point about the resource officer or some of the other things that have been talked about, you might add some fraction of them in or leave some of them out and give people a range of potential outcomes.
Yeah, it's honestly, it's largely, if you will, a marketing question as to how to present it. One way I could come at it is, if you know, assume there's no override. What's the FY18 budget look like? Here it is.
That's clearly one.
That's right. One way to do it. You know, rather than have multiple budgets, I would prefer a method that had a list of priorities, either plus or minus. And then
that's,
you just step through and you draw
so
a line somewhere.
Zero. Here you
correct.
Are with
yeah.
an add on a list.
Where would you
these
like
the,
to be?
These are the.
Yeah, and,
what
that,
we're
and that's.
Doing additionally to
yes.
What we
here's the shopping list.
You know, that's a discussion the town can do in isolation on its budget, and the school can do the same.
Right.
Where it gets difficult is what if we don't split it the historic way, either the pluses or the minuses?
What do you mean by that?
Yeah.
You have a $5 million override.
Yeah.
We don't do a 2/3, 1/3. There's a crying need for one way or the other to deviate.
Oh, the information.
How do you have that discussion? Or minus. How do you have that discussion? That's a tough one. But it's a fair one.
It's definitely
need the direction.
A fair one.
Yeah.
How will you spend your next dollar? It may not be the same.
See, I think people, I just think locally there should be enough control over it that people would know what's going to happen. And they ought to be able to vote their mind about that. It's not like sending it to the black hole, you know, on Beacon Hill or to Washington. Really, it isn't. We need to be clear with people about what the deal is and where it's going to go. And how it should be spent, and it doesn't necessarily have to track, you know, current spending. You got to figure we're starting at zero. What do we need to fix?
Yeah, I would, let's just work ourselves 6 months forward, and we've had a lot of discussion, and we've come up with some ideas. My guess is on this board, who's very like-minded in many ways, you'll have a lot of difference of opinions on granularity. Mm-hmm. And just multiply that by 25,000 residents. That's one of the issues. Is you'd like to present kind of a simple thing, but you've seen the financial forums where we've asked what service that you use, would you be cut? The answer is nothing.
Everybody uses everything.
How do you decide what to cut when no one wants anything
cut?
Okay,
but maybe you repeat the exercise with a price tag next to the top 25, and now suddenly a decision has what aren't you going to do kind of implications.
There are budget model software out there that does that. I don't know how good they are because it's more marketing, but it allows the residents to rank what's important to you.
I hate the word marketing here because it suggests promotion or
it's feedback,
or advocacy. But it's how do you present in a way that's clear and concise and without spin on the English on the ball?
Yeah,
we just make a budget that says this is what it costs to run the town, and as the town leaders, we put in there what we feel are the things that we really need to have. This is what it costs to run the town. And right now, that's X dollars more than what we're having now. And this is what we're asking you to pay. And we make the case for those things that we want to add that we don't currently have. There's a whole piece about, recruiting and retaining staff. I mean, that's not a very sexy kind of thing. It's not really adding anything.
No.
But if someone who's been doing a job for 25 years is the only one known in town and knows how to do it, and that person leaves to take a job in another town for $10,000 a year, I mean, we're losing a person, but we're also losing a service. And, I just think it's important for us to, as part of that transparency, say, listen, this is what we do now. This is what it costs.
It's part of the macro discussion, but I think to the extent you want to do ads or you need to give people options and let them vote with real money or vote with, I want this, but I don't want that. That's motherhood and apple pie, what you're talking about. And you and I get it because we swim in it and we understand it. But the average guy in the street says, I don't understand it. And they tend to disagree with you because they don't understand it. I'm not sure there's a role for this, but maybe we could reproduce what we do in town meeting floor with using the website, with putting some of the major items, the school resource officer or some of the other big ticket items, just to get, if no other reason, just getting people thinking about the alternatives.
Yeah, and it's certainly food for thought for the next chair of the Selectmen to wonder about how you solicit April town meeting's opinion. Not that they're the voice of the whole town by any means, but they're a portion, they're representative. What kind of feedback can you get?
Theoretically, they've been elected by
the
majority of voting citizens.
They're mostly independent contractors, I would say.
Do they? You don't think they're checking with their constituents?
Some do. Some do, and they're very good at it. Yeah, some do. All right, is there any further business to be discussed this evening? If not, I will hear a motion to adjourn.
Will the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting?
10:05.
Is good. Yeah.
Second.
Okay, all in favor? 5-0, lights out. Thank you, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Yeah. Thanks.
There's paperwork to be signed by all of you.